All right, as people are just still joining us, we're just introducing ourselves in the chat. Let's see, where are people coming from? I see folks from Texas, Orlando, of course, several Californians. So there's like Glendora, Arcadia. I know not everyone can see the chat. They're on their phones and stuff. San Bernardino, Bay Area, Mexico, Huntington Beach, New York, D.C., Bangalore. Sacramento, Orange County. It's scrolling too fast. Saw Japan in there, San Francisco, St. Paul, Minnesota, United Arab Emirates, literally around the world. Wisconsin, Hercules, LA, Palm Springs, probably cooking out there. Boulder, Colorado, Stillwater, Hong Kong. Welcome, everybody. Welcome. Continue to introduce yourselves. Go ahead and connect in the chat. We'll have the chat on for a while. So this is a chance for you all to meet. I'm going to turn the music down. But welcome. My name is James Angler. I use he, him, and they, them pronouns. And my official job title with Revelle College is Senior New Student Program Specialist, which is the long way of saying I'm the orientation coordinator for Revelle College. As you will hear again and again today, at UC San Diego, we have the college system. It's something we're very proud of. We're going to talk about celebrating 60 years of it. And so it means that this university is divided into 8 different sections, and students have different classes in those sections, and students have different staff in those sections. And so I get to be the orientation coordinator just for your students, just for Revelle College students. Hopefully get to know them and have been getting to know them. They all already attended orientation part one on Zoom, which is when they met with me and our advising team to go over signing up for classes. And they'll continue to meet with me and my orientation leaders next month when they come back for orientation part two. So it's exciting to meet you all. It's exciting to be here and start getting to know some of you all as family members. I also have been behind the scenes on some of the webinars that maybe many of you have been doing. I'll talk a little bit more about that with the different campus resources over the last few weeks. So welcome. Welcome to Revelle. Congratulations on being a part of Revelle and the Revelle family, as well as the UC San Diego family. You're all Tritons now too, if you weren't already. Before we go much further, I do want to just start with what's called a land acknowledgement. We know that this university is old, 60 years old, which is also very young in some senses. And so we want to just pause and reflect on the history of the land that this university was built on. I know you all are scattered around the world, but UC San Diego was built on the unceded territory of the Kumeyaay Nation. The Kumeyaay people have political sovereignty and cultural traditions that add to the rich history and diversity of the greater San Diego community. So we acknowledge that this land that this campus was built on is sacred to the Kumeyaay Nation. And if any of you come from the Kumeyaay Nation, we welcome you, we greet you, and hope that we can continue to heal the rifts between our communities. And the reason we do a land acknowledgement is just to reflect on the history of the land underneath us. This is a place of stories, and your students are going to contribute to that history. They're going to contribute to the story of UC San Diego. And the story is more than just UC San Diego. It's the history of this spot and this world. And so I invite you now to reflect on the histories of where you're at right now and the stories that have come before you and the stories that you're telling on that land. All right. I get to be your MC for the day. I'll kind of go over the schedule. I'll be helping when we have our panel later. But first, I'll just kind of tell you, what are we doing next? We're finishing up opening remarks for me right now. And then we're gonna have our, oh, I didn't change that slide. We're gonna have our amazing provost, Paul Yu, speak in a few minutes, and then we're gonna hear from our Dean of Student Affairs, Sherry Mallory, and we actually have our interim Dean of Advising, Veronica Abreu, who will be speaking as well. And we're gonna give you some time to ask some questions. This is the leadership of Revelle College. This is the people that oversee Revelle College as a whole, my boss's bosses kind of folks, and they're awesome. And so I'm excited for you to get to meet with them and get to hear from them. After that, we'll have a break because I know we're going to be on Zoom for a long time. Get away from the screen, 15 minutes, get your breakfast, get your second cup of coffee, whatever you need. For some of you, it's nighttime to get away from that. We will bring in some of our student leaders to be on a student panel, and you'll have a good hour to talk with them and just ask them questions directly. You know, what is my student going to go through? What do you want to know that can help you support your student? Again, well, after that, it'll go to about 10:15 California time, and then we'll have another break, and we'll end the day with remarks from our program assistant. Janet Lim, she's another staff member here. She's someone that's on the ground with your students. And she'll talk a little bit about a love letters program that we do, and even this family mixer for those of you that want to stick around during the lunch hour to actually talk and unmute and get to know each other a little bit more. She'll be moderating that as well. And so that's what our schedule is for the day. I just have a couple little announcements and stuff before we dive into hearing from Paul. We do e send these email blasts out periodically to families. That's probably how you got this link. Just kind of updates and what is the stuff that's going on with your students' lives right now. We also have been promoting our partnership with Parent and Family Programs. Parent Family Programs is basically like your college at UC San Diego. If your students have a point place in Revelle College, Parent Family Programs can be your point place for UC San Diego. They're the ones that help partnered with the colleges to put together that new family orientation hub. If you haven't joined it yet, I'll drop a link in the chat in a little bit. That is where we have our whole webinar series. We've had campus partners like Housing coming and talking about all the stuff that your questions you have about housing. We have CAPS, which is our counseling and psychological services on there, and they do this awesome presentation about how to transition with your student to college. Financial services, I was sitting on the webinar last night that they hosted, answering all the questions about how to pay the bill. So even if you missed a webinar, the recordings are still on the new Family Orientation Hub. So it's worth joining and it's worth kind of clicking through and watching those pieces. If you have more specific questions about any given resource on campus, it's a big campus. There's a lot of people here. It's its own city is really how you want to think about it. And it has a lot of different services to take care of that city. And there's no way I could go over everything with you all. So rather we try to bring the partners in to talk about it themselves and to allow you to digest it at your pace too. So if you haven't participated, I highly recommend it. And there's still time to do it. The hub will be open through September. So if you have questions later, you're like, oh, what did they say about paying the bill? You can go back in and watch the recording again and kind of get it directly from the office's mouth if you can't find it on a website. So I'll drop the link for that in a second. Those are my announcements. We'll come back to the break when we're on a break. I'm gonna pass it over to our provost now, Dr. Paul Yu, and I'll get your slides up, Paul, and we can go from there. Thank you all for being here. And thank you,
Thank
Paul,
you,
for
James.
joining us.
Thank you. So good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, parents and family. I can see that you are all over the world. And I'm Paul Yu, provost of Revelle College. And I'm also a distinguished professor at the Electrical and Computer Engineering at UC San Diego. Well, as provost, I'm very pleased to be among the first to welcome you and your student to our college. As mentioned by James, this is a very special year. We are celebrating the 60th anniversary of the founding of the college and the college system with your student. At Revelle College, we are very proud of our students. They truly represent a fascinating variety of talents, leadership, academic achievements, and backgrounds. We are committed to fostering such diversity in an atmosphere of mutual respect and support at the college. In today's section, you will learn about various programs and services available to your students. We assure you that your student will receive a world-class education at UC San Diego, and their experience at Revelle College will be both rewarding and enjoyable. Next slide. So I would like to first acknowledge Dr. Roger Revelle, the namesake of our college. Once described by the New York Times as one of the world's most articulate spokesmen for science, Roger was indeed a giant in American science. He was an excellent oceanographer, explorer, an educator, and administrator. In his later life, Dr. Revelle became a senior senator of science, giving counsel and guidance to the United Nations in areas ranging from the environment and education to agriculture and world population. He was one of the first scientists to recognize the dangerous global warming effects of rising level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Dearest to us, in the late 1950s, he recruited faculty from around the world to share his dream of establishing a new University of California campus in La Jolla, San Diego. He shared with faculty his vision to a college system that makes students feel living in a small village while enjoying the benefit of a larger university community. Next slide. The first college, Revelle College, commit from the first day to the principle of a broad liberal education that provides a solid foundation for major disciplines of sciences, humanities, arts, and social science. Next slide. During their time at Revelle College at UC San Diego, your student will acquire skill sets through leadership, research, and entrepreneurial learning experience, in addition to those acquired in education and in their majors. Your student will be well-equipped to meet the challenge in their careers. They will make the world a better place. Next slide. The student will meet the faculty and me through different activities such as Revelle Mondays each month, RAF, which weekly meeting inside our office space. We also have a Revelle mentoring program to matching students with their faculty mentor, and my one-to-one office hour with the students, and so on and more. We actually have professors leading global seminar every summer to visit and lecture in places like Rome, Edinburgh, Berlin, Madrid, and Chile next summer. So here we are very proud of our alumni. Your student will be among the celebrities such as those shown in these pictures. They are astronauts, biologists, science fiction writers, medical doctors, authors, engineers, entrepreneurs, and most important, they are excellent citizens. Next slide. And your student will be nurtured by our faculty, just like Nobel laureate Dr. Bruce Berner, Revelle class of 1978, who was once mentored by Professor Paul Price during his first year and later at Revelle College at UC San Diego. And surprisingly, Professor Paul Price still come to work after retire more than 10 years ago. He still meets students every day in his office. Next slide. Each year, we recognize our various scholarship recipients, honor students during the spring quarter. And this event will be joined by our faculty and the faculty who mentor these students, as shown in this picture, which is taken in the late May last spring. And the next slide. And each year at the commencement, the Revelle faculty and staff joined me to welcoming our graduating senior at the completion of their degree program at UC San Diego. They will be accompanied by their families and friends and greeted by the faculty and me. Okay. So I would like to invite here all the parents and family to meet us at my office whenever you are on campus. Now I would like to pass the microphone to the Dean of Student Affairs at Revelle College, Dr. Sherry Mallory. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Paul. I am just going to take a quick minute to get my slide shared and then we can get going. All right, I just lost my screen. Perfect. So as Paul said, I'm Sherry Mallory. I'm the Dean of Student Affairs at Revelle College. I want to talk a little bit about who I am and my background, just so you have that as context. So I'm a graduate of the University of California system. I'm a first generation college student who grew up in the Bay Area, went to UC Santa Cruz. I then went on to get my doctorate in higher education with an emphasis in student affairs. I have been working in higher education now for, this is my 30th year, and this is my 12th year at Revelle College. Prior to coming to Revelle, I have lived and worked at other institutions in four states. So I've been at the University of Arizona, at the University of Arkansas, and Western Washington University before coming back home to California. And I love UC San Diego because of the college system and because of the unique opportunities it provides to get to partner with parents and families and get to know your students. If I were the Dean of Students at UCLA, I would have about 50,000 students that I would be working to support. And with Revelle, we have just under 5,000. So I really get to interact with and know students from Triton Day through orientation all the way to shaking their hands when they cross the stage at commencement. Oh, let's see. Sorry, I am having just a glitch with my screen. Okay. All right. So as the Dean of Student Affairs, I'm responsible with the Student Affairs and Residence Life staff for your students out of class and co-curricular experience at Revelle. So in a few minutes, you'll get to hear from our acting Dean of Academic Advising, and advising really works with students on all of the academic components. My team works with students around pretty much everything else. So we have a director of Res Life and two assistant directors of Res Life who live on here at Revelle. And if you have a first year student who's coming into Revelle, there's a good chance that they'll live on campus with us here in Revelle College. If you have a transfer student, then they may be living elsewhere on campus. We also have our assistant dean of student affairs, our coordinator of student activities, who work with our student organizations, coordinate programs for our students to make sure they have opportunities to find community and be engaged and connect. James, who you've met, really focuses on that first year transition for new students coming to UC San Diego. And then we have support staff who work with me to help support our students. So I'm primarily responsible for working with students in crisis. I'm also responsible for overseeing student conduct. Not that I do a lot of it, most of it my team does, but we really are here to help keep your students safe, to get them connected to others at Revelle and beyond, to oversee community standards. And we're also here to provide support when things go wrong or when they may need a little bit of extra help, and to support you in supporting them as parents and family members. So one of the concepts that we talk about quite a bit in student affairs is this concept of self-authorship. And that's really about making the transition from relying on others to taking ownership and responsibility for one's own life. So we like to use this analogy of the two-seater bicycle. So we know when students come to us, they're coming to us in the backseat of that bicycle, right? Because they've had you, they've had teachers and advisors really doing the consistent peddling to help them navigate through K to 12, apply to college, figure out what they want to do. And what we want to do during their time at UC San Diego and Revelle is really help students make that transition up to the front seat to become independent thinkers who are ready to meet life's challenges as an adult. Now there's still gonna be a critical role for you as parents and family members. They're still gonna need the pedal power that you're going to provide, the love, the support, the challenge. We also, as staff, our student staff, our residents, assistants, advisors, others may need to, from time to time, sort of slip into that backseat to help students navigate the journey. But our goal really is to get them to a place where they're making decisions. They're still talking to you and working with you, but they're doing the heavy lifting and directing the journey. So I do just want to talk briefly about understanding the college student brain, because up until, gosh, probably about 15, 20 years ago, we thought that the brain stopped developing around the age of 15. And thereafter, that decisions could be made with reliability and maturity. And we now know from imaging studies that the brain is continuing to develop as students are here with us in college, and now doesn't reach full maturity until the mid-20s. So during the time that students are most likely to be with us, between 18 and 25, connections in the frontal lobe of the brain are still developing. And the frontal lobe, if you're not familiar, is the part of the brain that asks if what we're doing is a good idea. So it's the part that contains the structures that regulate decision-making, judgment, impulse control. And, you know, I mean, you've lived with your students, so you know, in calm times, they can make decisions and rationalize and work through things as well as we can. But under stress, that ability can sometimes quickly go out the window. So I think sometimes parents think like, oh, they're going to college, it's going to be fine. They're, you know, we're going to not see some of the things that perhaps we've seen up to this point. But there will continue to be times during the next couple of years where you definitely will be asking yourself, what were they thinking? So if you haven't done so, you will have access through the parent and family portal that James talked about to a session presented by our colleagues at Counseling and Psychological Services called Letting Go While Holding On. And that talks in greater depth about the transition to college for you as parents and family members, and for your students. I want to talk about a couple things that aren't talked about in that presentation. So for our students, the first quarter is often about adjusting to college life. For students, getting used to living on their own. For some, many getting used to sharing a room if they haven't had to share a room with a sibling in the past. Sort of finding their place, figuring out where they fit in. It's about learning to take care of daily personal needs, or what I like to call adulting, making sure they're getting enough sleep, eating well, doing laundry, managing expenses without that nudging that they often have from you to make sure that they're, you know, eating some vegetables and getting some salad and going to bed at a reasonable time. It never fails to amuse me how quickly students become nocturnal. You know, once they get here, they start going to bed later and later and start getting up earlier and earlier. Not all of them, but certainly some of them. Students are also going to be adjusting to college level classes, and above and beyond that to the fast pace of the quarter system. So if you turn on the news right now or look at a paper, right, you're going to see that there are universities and colleges across the country where students are going back now, where they're on the semester system, and those are 15-week semesters. When we start in late September, it will be a 10-week quarter. So students will start classes in about 3 weeks in, they'll jump into midterms. And it's ironic that our faculty call them midterms because really they're just exams that will run from around week three until week 9 or 10, and then they'll be transitioning into finals. But it tends to be incredibly fast paced. Classes are often less structured than high school classes, even AP classes. There tends to be more required reading. There may be less homework. Sometimes the grade is based on primarily exams. And students often find, because we have such high achieving students, they often find that things that worked really well for them in high school may not work for them in quite the same ways when they get to college. So they may have some challenges academically, keeping up. And with our students, sometimes they can lose a little bit of confidence around that. So it can be challenging. And then a common struggle that we see with our first year students is really just trying to figure out how to manage their time and to balance studying, socializing, and personal time. There sometimes is a tendency, and you as families may encourage, like, just focus on academics first. But actually, we know when students are involved, it can help them manage their time better. And so students who have one or two things that they may be doing, whether it's joining an intramural team or doing something like our Emerging Leaders Program or being a member of Revelle College Council or a student organization, having that structure of something can make a difference and can actually make it a little bit easier for them to focus on academics and manage their time. At some point during the first quarter or the first year, there's a good chance that things may begin to feel a little overwhelming for your student. This can happen after those first round of midterms come back, or it can happen later, or it may not happen until winter quarter, which always seems to be a rough quarter for our students. And I want to prepare you that when things get tough, you may get a phone call from your student. I mean, you may hear nothing. And so that may be a thing of, like, my student's not communicating with me and I'm worried about him. Or you may get the call of, like, I hate it here. I don't have any friends. There's nothing to do. My classes are hard. You know, you'll just sort of get the, here's the litany of all of the things that are going on. And I want to give you some context for that, because sometimes you're just getting a snapshot and they really are doing okay. And there are good things happening. If you get that, often the reason you get that is because students feel safe with you, and they feel like they can tell you the things they're struggling with. I wish they would just talk to one another, because what they don't realize is so many of them are going through the same things, but I think they feel like they're the only ones that are feeling whatever they're feeling, and they don't really want to talk to one another about it. So it may be siblings, it may be parents, where you'll get the sort of, everything is horrible, I hate it here, like, my life is awful, here are all the problems and please fix them. What you don't know is, if you do get that call, often your sleepless night begins because you've heard all of these things and now you're really worried and you're like, oh my gosh, I have to help. 5 minutes after they get off the phone with you, they're often down the hall playing video games or watching a movie or hanging out with their friends or getting something to eat because they feel so unburdened and so much better. So know that there may be things that challenge your students while they're here. They may run into issues. They may have roommate concerns. They may have trouble grasping things, but we have all of the resources here at the university that they could possibly need to work through those things on their own. So I want to encourage you, if you get that call, if you're hearing that your student is really struggling, maybe start by asking questions like, who have you talked to? Have you talked to your RA? Have you reached out to the dean? Is there someone, you know, have you looked into our teaching and learning, or UCSD's teaching and learning commons? Like, you know, encouraging them to use resources, and then maybe say, you know, why don't you think about it? Why don't we check in again tomorrow and see where they are with a little bit of time and distance? And if you can, really try to encourage them to solve things themselves and fight that urge to want it, to step in and solve it for them. And also, as I'm saying that, I want you to know that we're here to consult with you. So if you're not quite sure, reach out to us. I will, at the end of this presentation, make sure that you have my direct line, that you have my email, and I'm always happy to consult. I also want to say, you know your students better than anyone. And as parents, you have this finely honed spidey sense, I'll call it, right? When you just get that feeling in your gut that something's not right. So if you're hearing all the things, and it's also setting off that alarm of like, there's something more going on here, please, please, please reach out to us. We can help students get connected to resources. We can check on them in ways where we're not going to know that they've reached, you've reached out to us and we're checking on them. Like, we'll send their resident assistant to check in with everybody in the suite. It may be that there's one student that we're concerned about, but we just want to get a first look and sort of see how things are going and see if they'll open up to another student. And so we'll have the RA check in with everyone so we don't raise any suspicion. I think with that being said, it's safe to say that you as parents and family members and we as Revelle College staff have the same goal that we're working toward. We want to see your students thrive. We want to see them succeed. We want to see them achieve the goals that they've set out for themselves. And most importantly, we want to see them graduate. So how can we work together on that? What I just said, empowering your student to be a strong self-advocate and to work towards solving problems on their own, to encourage them to identify and use available resources on campus. You know, that could be campus offices, faculty. Revelle is their home base. They can always start with us. And I will stand in front of every new student coming in just a couple weeks, and I will share that same thing with them. And I will be there for probably just about every minute of every orientation session. I always try to be, because I know the dean title can be scary, and they can be a little intimidated. And I want them to know if they need anything at all to come to me, to come to anyone on my team, and that we're all committed to them and here to help. Asking them questions, you know, who could you talk with? Who have you talked to, as opposed to just jumping in and trying to fix it for them? And then, as I said, I want to reinforce, know that we're here as a resource for you. Parent and Family Programs is here as a resource for you. So you have resources and support to help you help your student. And as I said, also, if you're really concerned, please, please call or email us. So in the vein of resources, just a few things to leave you with. Revelle College on our website. We do have information for parents and families. I believe it's under student life. I meant to check before we jumped into this and forgot, but I will put it in the chat for you. Also on the far right side, contact, if you click on that, that will give you the contact information for all of our staff in the college and how to get in touch with us. If you have a student who's living on campus this year, Housing, Dining, Hospitality, which provides our undergraduate housing, has a page for parents and supporters. You can sign up to get housing communications. And I encourage you to do that because students are not always great about sharing with you. So that will give you information about important deadlines, housing news, things about move-in and such. So if you're not subscribed, I would encourage you to do that. And then of course, Parent and Family Programs are a great resource in terms of they have a lot on their website, but they're always there for you throughout the journey. So for those of you, particularly if this is your first student who's going away to college, I like to recommend this video by Professor Marshall Duke. It's a little dated, but I think the information is still relevant. He's a faculty member at Emory University, now retired for several years, but really talks about high achieving students and what making that transition is like as a parent and what it's like for your student. I have the link. We'll get this presentation up on our website so you can come back to it. But also if you go to YouTube and just type in parenting a college student, I believe this is still the first thing that comes up. And then again, my contact information. I will be here throughout the morning. So if you have questions for me, feel free to put them in the Q&A section. I encourage you not to share too much information about your students. So if you have questions that are specific to your students, please email me instead. But if you have general questions, feel free to put them in the Q&A and I'll work through them as we work through the morning. So thank you so much. I appreciate the time to spend some time with you today and look forward to partnering and working with you all over the next 4 years.
Thank you so much, Dean Sherry.
Thank you.
I dropped some of the links that Dean Sherry mentioned in the chat, including the Revelle page for families, so you can see like last year's recording of this webinar. You'll see where we'll put the recording for this webinar, and you can also see the Marshall Duke video. It's in the additional resources button on that page. So, I know a few folks dropped some questions in the Q&A. If you have questions directly for Dean Sherry, you're welcome to use that tool. If you drop it in the chat, it's going to get lost as the chat keeps going. And I'll also remind that we'll have a student panel starting at about 10:30. And Dean Sherry will still be here watching questions also. So if stuff comes up later that the students can't answer, we'll still have some staff behind the scenes answering. I'm now very excited to hand it over to our interim Dean of Advising, Veronica Bray, who is amazing, and to talk a little bit more about the academics here at UC San Diego.
Thank you, James. So yes, welcome. My name is Veronica Bray, pronouns she, her, and Aya, and I am the Assistant Dean of Academic Advising, or as they've been saying, Acting Dean or Interim Dean, but really the Assistant Dean. I am originally from the LA area and more specifically from Norwalk. So if you know the area, that's where I'm coming from. But because my husband is a Marine, I've also had the opportunity to live in Okinawa, Japan for 6 years and North Carolina for 6 years before coming back to San Diego, where he finally decided to retire. I'm also a first generation college student, so I know how confusing it can be to navigate all of this and how difficult it can be to ask for help. So I'm here to talk with you about advising services for your student and some basic information that we'd like you to know. So first, what is advising and what do we do? So academic advising is here to help guide your student through their academics. We are sort of like high school guidance counselors, but not. So I explain my job as making sure that students understand the requirements in order to earn their degree. What we don't do is choose classes for them. We can help them choose classes. We can help them find resources, understand policies, and ultimately earn their degree. There are a lot of rules. We know this, and we are happy to help them navigate the processes. Revelle Advising is a team of 8 professional academic advisors and 3 peer advisors. Our advisors are not assigned, so students can meet with any of the advisors on our team. Revelle College advisors are just one of the advising resources for your student. Many times, we are the first stop on a road to many. One thing I like to remind students of is that one of the great things about attending a massive university like UCSD is the amount of resources they will have available. However, the issue with attending a university this size is the number of resources can be overwhelming for some students. They may not know where to even start. So I want to explain the landscape of all advising services at UCSD, so if they ever come to you and are confused, you can have an idea of how to support them in getting help. As college advisors, we advise on the general education requirements. We have 8 different colleges on our campus, and every college has their own general education requirements. So each college, like John Muir College, Warren College, have their own advisors. We also focus on campus policies, academic difficulty, withdrawing from courses, and overall resources, because we do advise holistically. Students in any college can pursue any major. The requirements for majors are handled by the department advisors. If your student has questions about what classes to take to get into computer science major, for example, they will work with the department advisors to talk about their computer science requirements. Some students will also connect with faculty advisors who can mentor them and tell them more about academic careers and the nuances of that field. If your student is a scholar athlete, they will have an advisor in athletics. If your student is an international student or here on a student visa, they will also need to work with the International Services and Engagement Office to talk about visa regulations. The Career Center is a fantastic resource for students to use for their major and career exploration, as well as helping exploring graduate school options, including the HealthBeat advisors who work with students on pre-med requirements. Then there are two other types of advising that are separate that I want to mention. Financial aid and scholarships. Advising is for those with financial aid. We in advising do not have access to students' financial information or anything monetary. The Office for Students with Disabilities. If your student had an IEP or 504 plan in high school, they should connect with the OSD Office for Academic Accommodations now. Also, students with chronic health conditions or otherwise needing accommodations should register with OSD. The college advisors will not know that students are registered with OSD unless they tell us. So as you can see, this is a lot of support and can be confusing to navigate who does what. So if your student isn't sure, have them reach out to us as a starting point. Students can contact advising anytime through the Virtual Advising Center. Our academic advisors respond constantly during business hours. However, this is not an instant messaging system. It's a central messaging system, so all advisors can see what has been shared with the students. We use this instead of email, and we try to respond within 1 to 2 business days. Throughout the summer, we have sent a few different email communications to all new students. We hosted mandatory orientation, which included webinars for enrolling for students early in August, before they enrolled in classes. And last week, we had drop-in advising for the first 2 days students were enrolling. We have been answering back messages all summer. If your student says they haven't heard from advising or haven't connected with Revelle Advising yet, that should be a red flag for you. And please tell them to get connected to us as soon as possible through the Virtual Advising Center. Once the quarter starts, we offer drop-in advising for 10 to 15-minute questions and 30-minute appointments for long-term planning sessions. In the fall, we will continue to offer hybrid services, so we offer remote and in-person advising options. We will begin drop-in advising on Wednesday, September 25th, and we'll have 2.5 weeks of only drop-ins in order to accommodate as many students as possible. Starting October 10th, we will offer appointments in addition to the drop-ins, and all of our details are available in the Virtual Advising Center and also on our advising website. So I wanted to share a few things that I think it's important for you to know about your students' academic life starting at UC San Diego. So first, it is important to understand that most of our classes are in person. We have very few remote classes available that students can see in the schedule of classes. UCSD in general does not have many remote classes, and it's expected that students are here in person for their courses. If your student does have questions about their individual classes, they should reach out again to us through the Virtual Advising Center. Another thing to know is that classes on campus are scheduled from 7 a.m. until 9:50 p.m. to maximize classroom space. So your student may have a gap in their schedule. They may have midterms and final exams at different time from their scheduled class time, including later at night and Saturdays. Math, for example, has common exams across all sections that of a mid and or midterm or final that can go until 9:50 p.m. I know many of you had heard from your students as they have been enrolling the past 2 weeks, and they are likely talking about their classes and wait lists and professors. I will be very honest, they probably aren't going to get their number one choice of classes now or possibly ever. Enrollment times are randomly assigned by the registrar's office before each quarter by class level from seniors down to freshmen. We have no influence over them. For this quarter, continuing students enrolled back in May. Departments held some seats aside for new students starting in the fall. We also have no control or authority over wait lists. Those are all managed by the departments. So if your student is on a wait list for a class that they think they need or they won't graduate on time, tell them to reach out to advising. Usually that's not the case. Usually it's just a matter of swapping some classes. The department advisors can share the likelihood of getting off the wait list, which depends on the professor availability, TA assignments, and classroom availability. there are ways to be to flexibly shift student schedules as well. And we will be reaching out to students who are still on the wait list in a couple of weeks, because students do need to be enrolled in 12 units to be fully enrolled in order to be full-time and have full-time financial aid. My ask is to help normalize this to your student, that their number one professor or time or classroom or class might not happen, and that is okay. That is a reality of a large institution. Additionally, I want you to remember the 20-80 rule. So in high school, students learn about 80% of the course material during the actual class and then need to learn about 20% of it outside of the class. However, in college, students will learn about 20% of the content during their classes. The other 80%, they need to learn outside of class. So a few other things I want to share. Your student has access to many free tutoring resources, and they will need to use them. Even if they had a perfect SAT score or a 4.7 GPA, college at a large, research-intensive public university is a new environment. We have tutoring through the Teaching and Learning Commons and campus support units. We try to normalize asking for help because it's a new world here. Your student should be spending 2 to 3 hours of studying for every hour they are in class. For example, if a full-time student takes 12 units, which is 3 classes, so they are in class 12 hours each week, that same student should be studying at least 24 to 36 hours per week. If they are struggling to manage their time, we have resources to help with that as well. Most transfer students try to graduate in 2 years, and students admitted as freshmen will try to graduate in 4 years. But we recognize this isn't possible for all students, but this is our goal. If your students will be off this path, advising can help them. I also want to let you know that it's okay to not know which major you want to pursue or to want to change majors. This is normal and supported. One of the concerns that so many of the students we have when I talk to them about this is being afraid to disappoint you, their support system. So please help normalize change. If you want to know some of the most common questions we get, please check out our advising FAQ webpage on the Revelle College website. Now, due to federal privacy laws and student records, we cannot share information with anyone but the student about their academic record without the student's written permission. So we do encourage you to talk with your students about what they are going through. And here are some of the things you can ask them. Have you connected with peers for study groups? So one of the things research has shown that helps students through their college experience is to have study groups. I know my study groups were so helpful in helping me see where I thought I knew the material and then realized I had gaps in my knowledge. Good study groups are symbiotic relationships. So one student may not understand the concepts and will learn from the other student, but the other student doing the teaching can make sure that they truly understand the concepts, because if they can teach it, then they understand it. You can ask, which of your professors have you connected with? Using office hours to talk with instructors and TAs is so important. If students want to do research or pursue graduate programs later, they should talk to their professors. Professors cannot write good letters of recommendations for students they don't really know. And in a class of 150 or 400 students, they will not get to know the students unless the student makes the effort. They should especially contact instructors or TAs if they are struggling in a course at all. This can be intimidating to some students, but reinforce that faculty are real people. You can ask, how are your advisors? Who have you met so far? Ask about the advisors on campus to see if your student is seeking connection anywhere or realizes that numerous advising resources exist. You can ask them, how do you feel? Check in with them to see how they are doing and how they are feeling. They will be stressed out. They may feel pressured or lonely, or they may feel really excited about something they are learning or working on. If you're ever concerned about a student and are not sure what to do, please get them connected with us in Revelle College. And I want to close with just a couple of dates to be aware of. So your student's billing statement will be available via TritonLink September 4th. In order to see the bill, you must be an authorized payer on the account. The deadline to waive UC SHIP insurance without fees is September 14th. The deadline to pay fees is September 20th. The first day of instruction is September 26th, and the last day to add classes is October 11th. That concludes my portion, and I'm happy to answer any questions if needed.
Thank you so much, Veronica. And we have a couple minutes before we go on break. I know some folks have been using the Q&A tool to ask different questions, and like myself and Sherry and Veronica, we've been typing answers as they've been coming in. Seeing some questions about like how many classes is too many classes. Like I saw that in the chat of like, is four classes too many for a first year? Veronica, do you want to talk a little bit about like units and what four classes may or may not mean?
For sure. So I go more off of units, right? Because some classes are going to be four units, but we do have some labs that are two units. So we want students to be enrolled in a minimum of 12 units, which typically will be three actual classes. Especially their first quarter, we recommend 12 units max. Some students are, you know, super anxious and want to be enrolled in those 16 to 20 units, then I would say 16 units max. Again, as Dean Sherry mentioned earlier, students should get connected on campus. So I tell students, look, if you come to campus and 12 units seems easy peasy for you, great, start getting connected to those other resources. That way, when you move into winter quarter, you know, okay, now I can add an extra class. But the worst position to find yourself in is too many classes, and now you're overwhelmed and you can't navigate all of that. So 12 units your first quarter is perfectly fine. That's where we want you at. And then finding other areas to connect with students, because that's going to be what keeps them engaged and connected over the long run.
I should unmute. I see folks dropping questions in the chat. Try to drop them into the Q&A tool, because the Q&A tool, we can go through them at the pace that we need. So even if we go on break, we'll still be able to come back. Stuff in chat just gets lost in a few seconds if people start talking and greeting themselves, and once we start dropping links and things. I know we got a bunch of questions about housing, and Dean Sherry said she'd share a little bit just kind of general information. Like, we're not going to be able to give you all the different specifics about each housing move-in date and time and the emails that are going out. But Sherry, can you talk a little bit about some of the housing stuff that's been coming up? I know it's on everyone's mind.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm sorry for not doing that in my presentation. So the majority of first year students will be living with us at Revelle College in residence halls. If a student is a transfer, transfers tend to be housed together, and they'll be either in the Rita Atkinson's residences, the Village at Pepper Canyon East, or the Village at Pepper Canyon West. If a student has opted to live in one of the campus's living learning communities, so we have an LGBTQ plus living learning community, RASA living learning community, a Black African diaspora living community, those are housed in other colleges. And then if your student is sort of late coming in on this, so they miss some deadlines and are going to be offered housing out of the wait list, then they'll be placed where space is available. But the majority of first year students should be living here at Revelle College. Revelle, I think I'm trying to find out if it hasn't already gone out, when it will go out. They send welcome letters. So the residential area that your student is going to be living in for the year will send them all of the information about move-in. Students will be able to move in starting on Wednesday, September 18th. And I encourage you, if there's any way for you to be able to swing it, to come in on Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday, because the newest college, 8th college, is right next to us, and we share a parking structure. So we'll have, between the two colleges, about 3,200 students moving in out of that same parking structure. And it's going to be really, really, really busy Saturday, Sunday. We also, and James has made this clear with your students, students can't move in on the day that they've signed up for orientation. You need to do move in on a day other than the day that you're going through orientation, because orientation is an all-day program. So if you're able to get in early at all, I encourage you and your students to try to do that. Students are given a window of time. Someone I think had put in the Q&A 15 minutes. I looked at the current guidance for Revelle and it's actually 30 minutes. That's just a pull into an unloading space, unload your car, get everything into the room. And then you have unlimited time. You'll just have to move your car for the next set of families to come and pull in and get their stuff unloaded. So you can spend as much time as you want with students. It's really nice. We now have a Target on campus. So it used to be that families would have to make a Target run to Mira Mesa. And now you can just go right on campus and get any things that you get here and discover, oh, I forgot to pack hangers. Okay, we got you covered. So that's a little bit about move-in. We will have move-in carts available for students to check out, but they're really only able to keep them for that 30 minutes and we have a limited number. So if you have mini fridges or microwaves or things that are a little heavier, if you have a dolly that you can bring, that's always super helpful. I'll throw a couple links in the chat for you so you have access for them, but hopefully that gives you a little more of a sense about housing. For students living at Revelle, they should have been able to access their housing assignments, I think, on the 21st of this week. If they're living in another residential area on campus, they all have different dates, but I'll drop the link where you can look up that date. And then any specific questions about the logistics of moving in would, again, go to the Res Life office where your student is living. So if they happen to be living up in International House at ERC, you would reach out to ERC with questions about move-in specifically. Everything else, you'll still come to us at Revelle because your student is a Revelle student. And if you're not sure, always start with us and we're happy to be the ones to help you figure that out and get you connected and get your student connected to the right place. So if you have additional questions, if there are things are missed, again, please feel free to drop them in the Q&A. I'll be hanging out during our student panel for the rest of the time and we'll do my best to answer everything.
And I would add that some families are sharing that their student has started receiving their move-in information even from Revelle. We're kind of in the later end on that list of move-in stuff. So today, this morning, soon is the safest answer we can say. But it sounds like some students are starting to receive information. And again, to reiterate kind of some of the stuff I'm seeing in the chat, not in the Q&A, if you're living like in Pepper Canyon or if you're living in another place, you're going to get a specific your student is going to get a specific set of instructions. And so it's really hard to say, well, this one's going to be on this day and this one's going to be on this day, because every community has slightly different plans, given where it's located, given if there's construction, given the parking, given a lot of different factors. And so it's the beauty of UC San Diego is that we have all of these different areas and we're one of the largest residential campuses in the country. But the challenge is then you have to kind of pay attention to the specific communication that you're getting. We can't just give a blanket, it's going to be like this.
Yeah. And students have to sign up for in-person orientation before they know the specifics of their housing situation. So your student may find themselves now with conflicts or trying to figure out how to navigate that. Can you talk just a quick minute, James, about what they should do in that case?
Absolutely. And I was chatting with our Residence Life team yesterday too, to kind of knowing that that is coming. The biggest conflict will probably be on Wednesday, September 18th, which is the first Revelle move-in day and move-in day for most communities, and also our first Revelle orientation. Students should be able to select the move-in time that works for them. And so they could select to move in on, say, the 19th or the 20th, depending on your situation. If you really cannot come any other day but move in on the 18th, you would email me at revelleorientation@ucsd.edu, which I'll put on there. Myself and my team monitor that email. And we can get the student moved to a different orientation date. We have three orientation days for first years. That's the 18th is a first year orientation. If you're a parent of a transfer student, the first orientation is on the 19th. But that's why we offer multiple days. So if you're really hitting a wall, we'll get you moved. But just try not to plan on moving in on the same day as orientation. You're just not going to be able to do both, and families aren't going to be able to move their student in while their student's at orientation. It's just not going to work that way. So hopefully that will ease some of the stress as you're starting to like pick your move-in days and plan your travel and all of these things that are coming up. We've already had several students, particularly like international students that are booking flights, reach out, and I've been able to get folks moved around. Some of these questions that I'm seeing are going to be great for our student panel that's going to be coming on in a little bit. So we're not tackling them all right now.
Can I answer a couple? Do we have time?
Yes, but I think if this would be a great time while we still have like Veronica and Sherry to kind of give these broad answers.
Thank you. So first, I know there's questions about the Revelle Honors and Revelle Seminar that went out, the invitations to students. So those are not required courses, and they are tiny. They're 20 students out of what we have over 1,200, 1,300 students coming in. They're just extra support, but they're not counted towards any degree requirements. So don't feel like if your student didn't get in, then they're, you know, going to be behind or missing something. They can still participate in honors programming. I sent that link in the chat. That class is just an extra class, and it's more to get connected with faculty and things along that line. So again, the classes are tiny, and the Revelle Honors, I think we had over 400 students qualify for it because you have to have a 3.8 high school GPA or better, and over 400 students have that. So for 20 seats, they're not all going to get in. So if you're concerned about honors programming, be sure to look at the webpage for that information. They can still participate. There's questions about the 2080 rule. So the students should plan on doing the reading before class. So if they show up to class and have not done the reading, they're going to be behind because they're not going to know what questions to ask. They're not going to know what they don't understand. They need to have come to class doing the reading, doing any prep questions, studying ahead of time, and then the lecture piece will just be the clarification piece. So if they are not doing that part, they're going to be behind. And they're also going to have to do any labs or extra work, assignments, projects outside of class. So a lot of the work is done outside of the classroom. Very little of it will be done inside the classroom. So I know my kiddo is in high school right now and they get a lot of time to do their projects in class. That's not the case here. Here they have to plan to do their projects outside of class. They have to meet up with their teammates outside of class. And that's where they need flexibility in their schedule too, because they're not always going to be able to meet at the same time. So they need to be able to coordinate with other students for different projects. So yeah, there's going to be a lot of work that happens outside of the classroom. Was there any other ones that you saw, James, for me? Change of majors. The students, there's a web page, but they can start changing their majors as soon as fall quarter starts. If they are selecting a non-selective major, which means that it's not limited to the number of students, then they can do that automatically right away as soon as classes start. But if they're choosing a selective major, like most of the engineering degrees, biology, public health, then there are some requirements. So they should go to the department webpage, review it, and see what are the requirements for changing into the major. And again, just because they meet the requirements to change into the major doesn't mean that they necessarily will get in, because there are limited seats. So that means that the demand is higher than the department can accommodate. So not all students who want to major in that department may get a seat. But again, there's lots of different options for getting to where they want to go, so that they don't get into their, you know, first major. There's different options, and definitely Revelle Advising can help with that. So have them come meet with us to talk about the different options for all of that.
May I say a few things about the honor seminar? So first of all, thank you, Veronica. We have two sections of the honor seminar this coming quarter. Each one will be holding 30 students, but I intend to increase it to 40. So we all together will have 80. However, if you cannot get enrolled this, your student cannot get enrolled this quarter, no worry, we have that honor seminar offer in the winter and spring quarter. So that the opportunity for your student. And in addition, we also have the first year experience course, which is REV1, which also taught by professors. And we'll be also acquainting your student with resources available, including the research and others. So the please also take a look at that one as well.
Thank you, Paul. I'm gonna call us here to make sure that when everyone gets a break, and two, again, some of these questions our students will be able to talk about and give that perspective of what it's like to move in or what it's like to be a commuter student. We've gotten some questions about that. I'll just reiterate one last thing. Move-in, there is no earlier move-in than September 18th. That is the first day of move-in. So some folks are asking, can I do an earlier move-in? You can move in the window of September 18th all the way through the 4th. But really it's like through that weekend is when most folks are gonna be moving in. And the student will be able to adjust that time. So if you're like, well, we need to move in on the 20th instead of the 19th, the student will be able to do that through the housing portal. So they're getting all of these instructions right now. So I know there's just a lot of questions about that, and we don't have all the details either because each community is going to be different. So just wanted to kind of reiterate that about the move-in window time. The 18th is the earliest. I want to give you all a break. I know we've been on Zoom for a good hour straight, and we all need to stretch, walk away from our computers. Like I said, whatever you need to do. So since we went a little over in this first half, I'm going to give us 15 minutes. Let's return. It's 10:10 here in California Pacific time. So let's return at 10:25 and we'll have our student panelists come on board and answer a lot more questions. And that'll give us time to parse through the Q&A as well. So I'll put a slide up. Go ahead and take a break. We'll see you back in 15 minutes.
algo para ti, algo excitante. Mi jarabe te levanta de la tumba. Es un jaleo para que siempre estés adelante. Un poquito de mela, sazón y rumba. Es un pasito que te voy a enseñar. Un meneito que sé que te gustará. Y cuando aprendas a bailarlo con sabor, te aseguro que este ritmo gozarás. Se baila así, se goza más. Se baila así, se goza más. Se baila así, se goza más. Se baila así, se goza más.
been holding my breath. I've been counting to 10 over something you said. I've been holding back tears while you're throwing back beers. I'm alone in bed. You know why I'm afraid of change. Guess that's why I stay the same. So tell me to leave. I'll pack my bags, get on the road. Find someone that loves you better than I do, darling. You remind me every day I'm not enough, but I still stay.
Feels like a lifetime just trying to get by while we're dying inside. I've done a lot of things wrong, loving you being one, but I can't move on. You know I'm afraid.
Alrighty.
Of
I'm back on. I'm going to get our student spotlight and then I'll turn the music down.
So tell me to leave. I'll pack my bags, get on the road. Find someone who gives you all of the things I could not know. Cause I keep fighting all the ways I let you down so I can stay.
Then tell me to leave,
and baby I'll go, and baby I'll go.
All right. As folks are coming back from break, I'm gonna stop sharing screen. This is our chance to really dive into the questions. I'll turn the chat off in a second, and just allow folks to throw things into the Q&A. Before we introduce our amazing students, I would love to introduce our Assistant Dean of Student Affairs, Melina. She's my direct supervisor. She's an awesome resource to your students here in Revelle. And I'm going to talk a little bit about her role and the role of her team and other ways that we support Revelle students, including our orientation leaders. So, Melina, I'm going to spotlight you if that's okay. And we'll go from there. Welcome, Melina.
All right. Hi, everyone. James, thank you so much for that playlist during break time. I really enjoyed it. Thank you all for being here today. My name is Melina Ramesha. I use the she, her pronouns, and I am the Assistant Dean of Student Affairs here at Revelle College. I do want to say, as a mom myself, I do understand the importance of creating a supportive environment for your students as they embark on their college journey. And we've got several parents here who really understand that experience. And so I feel like we're really lucky here in the Revelle community to be able to support you in that way. In my role, I focus on supporting students beyond the classroom through various programs that help encourage their engagement with their peers and also our dedicated staff. So your students are in excellent hands here with our staff at Revelle. I've worked here at Revelle for the last 15 years, and we have a very special community here. I know I'm biased because I work here, but I've also stayed here because of the people and the staff here. I work closely with our team, so that includes James, our orientation coordinator, Wes, our coordinator of student activities, as well as Janet, our program assistant. And together we aim to help students find their place here on campus, feel like they belong, build meaningful connections through our orientation programs, through student activities, and also leadership opportunities, which we're really fortunate to have many of those here at Revelle. In terms of ways that folks can interact with our staff and also fellow students, we do offer a Lego and coloring club office hours, just a way for students to de-stress while they're asking the questions that they need to. We also have regular coffee and tea chats with our staff members, and that includes our provost, our deans, and student life staff come out for those. And I noticed there's some parents of transfer students in here. And so specific to transfer students, this fall I'll also be hosting Transfer Tuesdays on select Tuesdays, and we'll feature special topics and opportunities for students to connect with each other. I'm also finishing up my doctorate. My research is focused on the lived experiences of autistic college students. I'm particularly passionate about supporting students with disabilities as well as all students. And I encourage your students to reach out directly if they have any questions about getting involved, about resources, if they just need somebody to listen. They've had a good day, they've had a bad day, they just need somebody there for them. Or if they're, you know, have questions about developing their leadership skills. And so my goal is to make sure that your students have what they need to thrive here at Revelle and UC San Diego. And what I tell your students is that my office is always open. I've got snacks in my office. It's a place where they can come and feel comfortable. And your students are welcome to come into the office. We're on the third floor of Galbraith Hall. We're there all week. And I also want to put my contact information for you here in the chat in case you have questions. So it's there. As we head into this student panel, you've got some fantastic students here with a range of experiences. And so I really encourage you to take advantage of, you know, being able to ask them the questions that you have. And so I might suggest asking things like, what resources have helped you out academically? How can my student get involved in campus life? What's the time commitment? How did you choose your co-curricular activities? What has been your experience been like living in on-campus housing? I know there's been a lot of housing questions and there's always a lot of stress around that. Ask these students so that you can feel a little bit more comfortable hearing from students who've gone through it. Also, what advice do you have for managing stress, particularly during midterms and finals? We have a quarter system, which is, it's different than a semester system. And so it takes a little bit of adjusting. And speaking of adjusting, you know, ask those questions about what was the hardest part about transitioning to college. And also, in what ways did your family support you from afar that were helpful for you? These are just some suggestions. I know you have all your questions too, and the students are going to be able to answer all of these questions and more. So just thank you again so much for being here. I look forward to supporting your students, and please contact me if you ever have any questions. So James, I'm going to kick it back to you for this panel and we'll get started.
Thank you so much, Melina. All right, I'm going to kick it over to our students. I'm going to spotlight them as I spot them. There is BG. Here's Alex. All right, and we got one more. Where's Mish? There you are. Awesome. All right, I'll be spotlight too since I'm going to be emceeing this. All right, you can see all of us now. Thank you so much, students, for being here. I mean, I know not all of you are here in California right now, but at early 10 a.m. on your summer break, and joining us to talk to our families and to share a little bit of your story. I'm going to have you all introduce yourselves. So if you can please just share your name, your pronouns, your year, your major, and maybe some things that you think you'd want parents to ask you about. This could be like orgs you're involved in or research experiences you've had if you're a commuter living on campus. Some of the stuff that may be in your bio that might be helpful for parents to know about you so they could ask questions. And we'll just do it alphabetically. So Alex, you can go first.
Hi, yes. Very nice to meet everyone. Nice to be here. Thank you so much. My name is Alexander Tejas. My pronouns are he, him. I'm a third year double major in an engineering course. I'm a nano engineer and a biology. I'm going for pre-med. So I'm doing research in both trying to do drug delivery and virus delivery within different ways of delivering that to the body to replicate forms of cancer killing pathogens. I'm involved in research here at Steinmetz Labs on campus. I volunteer at the UCSD hospital and I volunteer at a soup kitchen as well. So if you have any questions on how a student can go about volunteering here, I'm here. Yeah, that's pretty much all there is to me. Thanks so much.
Trying to figure out if they can do the alphabet. Idalia, you're next.
Okay. Okay, so hi everyone, my name is Adalia Fernandez. I go by the pronoun she, her, hers. I'll be a third year this fall majoring in public health with a concentration in medicine sciences. So also on that pre-med track. And then like so far, like one of the major steps I've done to like become like involved, like not only in Revelle, but like UCC in general, is becoming an orientation leader. So other than this amazing job, which like, thanks James, I'm in the organization, American Medical Students Association, otherwise known as AMSA. And I get to like participate in lots of like volunteer opportunities. Like literally yesterday I was volunteering at like a senior memory care like and hospice facility. So also if you have any questions about that, let me know. I thought that was really fun. I can answer questions about that. But I was also a part of like Summer Bridge my first year coming into UCSD. So I know a lot of like parents like have their children right now doing summer bridge classes. And I personally thought it was a good experience. So if there's any questions about that, I can also answer that. But yeah, that'll be it about me.
Miss, you're up.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. It's really nice to meet everybody. My name is Mishti Sood, but you guys can call me Mish. And my pronouns are she, her, and my major is business economics with a concentration in accounting. And I'm a fourth year, and I'm also a transfer student and an international student. So I think some things that you all can ask for me are my experience, my experiences through that at my time at Revelle. And yeah.
Hi. Hello. My name is Stephanie Venegas Solorio. It's very, very nice to meet you all. I am a second year cognitive and behavioral neuroscience major. I'm also on the pre-med track. I use she, they pronouns, whichever ones you like. It's fine. And a little bit like about me, I'm a first generation Latina student. I am away from home, so I have been on the housing in UC San Diego. And although I haven't had as many like leadership or involvement in Revelle or the university in general, like Adalia said, being a Revelle orientation leader is such a nice job, and it really made me like come out of my shell. So if you have any questions on that.
Hello everyone, nice to meet you all. I am Viji Geisha, you can also call me Viji, and I use she, her pronouns. And in fall, I'm gonna be a third year, and my major is cognitive science, and I'm specializing in machine learning. And on campus, I really like being involved in club activities, like regardless of whether or not I'm a part of the club. So yeah, you can ask me questions about student involvement on campus. That is something I'm really passionate about. I also recently moved off campus. I know that is something that is a concern for you a few years down the line, but if you have any questions about that, please send them my way. Thank you.
And folks, I see some questions are starting to come into the Q&A tool. Go ahead and drop your questions there. But just to kind of warm up, can you all share what is something that your family did for you to help you transition to college?
Yeah, I'm an only child, so it was definitely something difficult to transition from a high school that's right down the street from where I used to live in San Bernardino. So my parents, technically, they never graduated from college, or they didn't gain a higher education. So I'm the first in my family. I'm first generation. So I came in blind. They tried to help me as much as I let them to. They really pushed me to settle down first, get to know the campus, go out, make friends. Definitely like don't just sit in my room. They wanted me to go out, explore, look for opportunities, not just stay within the confines of my room. And that's definitely what pushed me to really get involved in research and also volunteering opportunities. Really going out, really meeting people, connecting, There's a lot of activities where you can go out, connect with people, lab opportunities, internship opportunities that UCSD really pushes out towards in emails and flyers around campus. And I really went out there, and that's how I was able to take part in a lab, but also an internship for immunology. So really them pushing me to settle down, take a breath, really relocate myself and where I was going to stay on campus for the first 2 years, and really go out and meet new people is what has helped me become the person I am today here at college. So yeah.
I think I'm going to take more of a, like, an emotional route to answer this question. But for me, I was like super adamant about moving out and living the whole like quote unquote college experience. Right. So my mom was totally against it at first. She was like, no, I want my baby to stay home. Right. Like, it was something like we like fought over in the beginning, but like, it was something that she like came like to grow, like, and to like accept. And like the first thing that I can think of was when she called me into her room one night and was like, hey, I'm looking at online. I'm looking at like Costco, looking at Walmart, looking at Target. Let's do some like online shopping for like your residence hall. And it was like that one moment in my head. I was like, wait, she's kind of okay with me moving away to college, right? So we ended up picking out my room, like color, like aesthetic. It ended up being gray, if anyone has any questions about that. But it was like that thought for me was like, wait, like, she cares. Like, it was a huge step, and I feel like that made us closer. And then like once being on campus, something they did was like they called and they texted me every so often to check up. And like even right now, if you go through my text messages, my dad, it's a bunch of good night, good night, good night. Like, they'll throw a little monkey meme in there too, like screenshot off Pinterest, like just that like small communication. Like, I feel like it's helped me transition to college. So yeah.
For me, I think my family really helped me by being supportive of my independence by moving away. They definitely encouraged me to take my own decisions while still being there if I needed advice. For example, my sister, who was a few years ahead of me, graduated by the time I transferred to UCSD, and she helped me set up my dorm and, you know, my room, picked out my aesthetic, everything. But I think at the end, they really trusted me to handle my schedule and daily responsibilities on my own. I think this balance of just support and trust that they created for me really made this transition a lot more smoother. And I think that had a lot to do with the fact that they weren't here physically, because I am an international student. My parents didn't come all the way here to drop me off to school. So yeah, I think that was a really good help for me. But yeah, thank you.
I think similar to Alex, I am an only child as well. So my mom is a single mom. So we're like this. We are very tied to each other. We have been with each other for like our entire lives. And her wanting to support me and support my decision anywhere and like wherever I see fit was the most important thing that my mom could have done. We're also of low income. So the most impactful thing that she told me was, Mija, you choose whichever university you want to go to, whichever you see fit for your future. I will make ends meet any way I can. And just having that support there is the most like important thing that I could have asked for. She's also from Mexico, so she doesn't know anything of like how college works here or like any of the processes. So I had to kind of find that out on my own. And again, her support of being like, Mija, I don't know what to do to help you, but if you need me to do something, if you need me to go to San Diego, and which was a huge thing to say because we live about 8 hours from San Diego. She was like, if you want me to drive to San Diego, I will, if you really need me to, but I just want to help you in any way I can. Like Dahlia, we also have constant communication. If I am on my phone, I am either checking my inbox on emails or texting my mom. but, you know, we have that connection. And that's, I think that's really, really important for students here.
Oh my God, I didn't know a lot of us were like only child here. So like coming from that, I feel like because I'm an only child, a lot of my parents and my lives like revolve around each other because like we would just be together so often and they don't have another kid who would bother them once I left the house. And so like something I really like right now is while my parents encourage me to like be involved over here on campus and like find my own purpose, do what I need to do, I also like encouraging them to find new hobbies and now do something with their time now that I'm away. And then every time my parents give me little updates about, hey, today we checked out this new place or I made a new friend. And that makes me really happy in a way to see that they are also doing fine on their own. So I feel like this is like a two-way relationship over this one. And so maybe that is something I would suggest, like let your children see that you're doing well too. Like all of you are going to, your child is going to be homesick, but they also want the best for you. And also I'm an international student. So another thing that my parents did that I initially maybe thought was silly, but so when I came here, I did not know anyone in San Diego. And so my parents made sure to like speak to like their friends and just like find out like any random person who we knew and made me speak to them and was like, hey, this person is going to be around you. Like as much as we want to, we can't really come help you in case of need because we are so far away. So they just made me have like a contact or like someone who I can trust to call like in case things go downhill. I never had to, but it's really nice having that kind of sense of security. I know college is daunting, like sending your kid away, even if it's like a few miles away or like a completely different continent. So, but that still is something that made me feel really safe. And I really appreciated that my parents went out of their way to find a few people who I could trust. And yeah, and another thing is that especially like while moving in and like the first few months of college is I'm definitely a person who always worries about like, oh my God, am I missing something? Did I forget to do something? So they really helped me with the whole like moving in process, making sure that I was like fully equipped to like live independently. And also I would earlier hesitate to like reach out to either like the college or the housing administration about any questions that I had, but they used to always encourage me that no, you need to get that clarified. So maybe that also is something that gave me more confidence in handling issues by myself and asking questions. Yes, thank you.
All right, we're getting a lot of questions in. Let's start with the theme of housing, since a lot of you all referenced that. Can maybe one or two of you just talk about what it was like to live in the residence halls? Maybe describe like, were you in a double, a triple, single, like how that all went? Maybe just have like one or two of you talk about that so we have time for all the questions.
So yeah, I lived in Argo Hall. It was a wonderful experience. I lived in a double. What Argo Hall has, it's suites. So you have your own individual room with if you're a triple, double, single, and then about 12 other people, 12 to 14 other people. I think that being in the residence hall was actually a awesome experience, mostly because I, one, learned to live on my own and kind of come out of my shell a lot. But because I have those 12 other people that I was living with, they became some of my very first friends here. And I became so attached to them. And we started hanging out. We started like, you know, getting to know each other when we were moving in. People would pop in and would be like, hi, I'm your neighbor in so-and-so room. And like, I hope you are chill and are awesome. And it was just a really nice like vibe, basically. It's also really nice that we were really close to the dining hall, so we would all kind of congregate to the dining hall to have lunch together, and it was just an awesome experience, in my personal opinion.
I can also jump in there. I also lived in Argo Hall in a double my first year, but I think Steph kind of killed it with her explanation. I agree with everything she said. I became super close to all of my suite mates. So I ended up living with them in my second year housing, which is called Keeling Apartments. It's less of a suite style. It's more of an apartment style. So it has six people that you live with. So two doubles and then two singles. I knew everybody except one person that we moved in with. And even that one person was super chill. I had a really great experience with that. I would recommend living on campus just to like see how it goes and everything. But yeah, if anybody else has anything to add there.
I would name that. The choices are made at this point if you're going to live on campus or not. But Mish, I think you had your hand up. Really quick thing to add.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that I had the same experience. All my friends, my first friends that I ever made at UCSD were my roommates. I lived in a mini double at Rita Atkinson Residences, which is a transfer housing. And I think as a transfer student, it also really helped me make friends because the whole building was transfer students. And I think just meet, and it was the same thing. Everybody, I remember the first day I moved in, people were knocking at our door being like, hey, like, we live next doors, here's some cookies, like, you know, it's really nice to meet you, we live down the hall, or we live in this room, like, we would love to meet with all of you and like hang out. And I think some of my friends that I made throughout the year was from those experiences. So I think, yeah, definitely a really good experience living on campus.
We're going to transition to off-campus in a sec too, but I saw a question just come in. Anything that you absolutely needed that you didn't pack originally that you're like, oh, I should have got that, or maybe something that you brought but you didn't actually need to bring and you never used it again?
I think something that I forgot to pack and I had to go buy for the first week that I was living was a fan, because it just gets really hot. And I think it's just a really good thing to have, like a personal fan in your room, even a smaller one. It doesn't have to be like a huge one, even like a mini one just on your table or on your bedside. I think it's a great investment. Yeah.
I agree with Mish. I went in my first day and it was so hot and I could not bear it. So a fan is definitely a necessity. And I think I would say like a mirror, like a long mirror is also something that I didn't realize that I needed, because I would constantly want to see how I would present my day, like present myself throughout the day. So I was like, I don't know. So I got one of my friends to send me a full body mirror, and it was the perfect thing that I needed. Everyone in my suite crowded into my room to use my mirror. So I would say a full body mirror.
And I know I clearly didn't vet you all for doubles or triples. You all are very lucky to have so many doubles. Did anyone live in a triple and maybe can talk about managing that space?
I did.
Okay, thanks. I see a question particularly about like, will a fridge fit in? How do you manage being in a triple?
I lived there for about a month before I was moved. I was here for Summer Bridge, and it was definitely it was a bit cramped for sure. The way I did it, or I guess me and my roommates, we're able to fit about one mini fridge in there, or about two mini fridges in there, I would say. With good space organization, you can definitely fit in two mini fridges. I know there was some parents asking about that. So you can definitely fit your own. The beds are adjustable, but the way we went about it was we did it in the Argo Argo Hall. So it was a bunk bed for one of them, and then it was a very high bed for the other one. They're high adjustable for that matter. So you can put some boxes underneath the bed, you know, for some spatial organization. It was definitely, it definitely felt good living with other people, but it also, it might be an adjustment for other people as well. As an only child, I've only had my own room, but I definitely enjoyed living with other people and really going about seeing how other people live and going about it, solving roommate problems by not just also talking about it, but sitting down. Hey, I, you know, not being aggressive about it, but hey, I just wanted to share that I can't go to sleep because you're on your phone too late or you have your volume too high. If you could please like set it down. Going about that really influenced me on how I behave here, not just on UCSD, but outside in my, you know, everyday life. There was definitely some noise things that I had to talk to with my roommates because they went out more. They did a lot more. I was still trying to adjust to a quarter system here at UCSD. So it was definitely something I had to talk to them about, like, hey, this was definitely a problem here. How can we go about to solve it? Noise canceling headphones or any type of AirPods that noise cancel, any type of headphones that cancel the over the ears are definitely a must. It's not just here on campus, but definitely off campus. If you're looking for off campus housing, I myself, if I'm off campus now, so I'm commuting there every day. Especially over the summer, I am doing summer school, so I'm commuting onto campus for research, for my activities as well. It's definitely something difficult that's hard. The noise management is very difficult, at least on campus. If there's not construction, especially because 8th College is just being finished right now, I had to deal with that where I would be up till like 2 studying, but all of a sudden I'm awake at 7 because the construction workers are allowed to work at 7 now. So it was definitely, you know, put my earbuds back in. Oh, I can go back to sleep now. Just something to block out the noise. It was really, that was really my only concern, but it was definitely enjoyable to live with other people and to just explore how it felt living with it. There's definitely space. And I think, there's definitely enough space to fit too many fridges. I know that was a big concern from the questions I'm reading in the chat.
Thanks, Alex. And yeah, I think all of our students are kind of describing the different ways that folks are adjusting to just for some folks, it's the first time they've ever had roommates. And how do you manage that? And headphones and talking about who's going to bring the fridge so you're not all bringing 5 mini fridges, right? Like those are, I think, some good tips that you all shared. Alex talked a little bit about commuting. Can folks talk a little bit more about what the commuter life is like? Most students eventually move off campus, and so we'll have to navigate commuting even if they're not doing it this coming year. And we do have some incoming students that are commuting already. So can you all talk a little bit about that and maybe even like talk a little bit about like your UPass and that kind of stuff too?
Yeah, definitely. There's the UPass you get, you'll be able to set it up. It should be, I think we go over it in orientation, I believe, or you'll be getting an email within the student portal of the student email, the at UCSD one. That's how I set it up and that's how I went about it. UPass is just your way of getting on the campus buses or any of the MTS public transportation. You just have to scan it. And then if anybody asks you, you can just pull it up on your phone. It's a simple app. It'll generate a barcode that you can just scan and that you can get on. It's only available during the school year, not during the summer. So if the student is doing summer housing, they definitely will have to log on to the permits website, I believe, to buy it. And then from there they can use, it's just generated throughout the summer. But during the school year, it's just generated automatically. You'll be able to log in and access not just the trolley, but also the public transportation. That's what I use to get on campus. I also have a vehicle to get around for my volunteering jobs here on campus and research as well, just in case like I'm a bit late or I just want to go out, something like that. It's definitely, vehicle is not a must. Personally, to be honest, it's much more of a hassle to get parking here on campus with a vehicle than also to just commute, to be honest. A lot of apartments have their own parking spaces and that's great, but UCSD doesn't have the greatest parking spaces here on campus from my experience, and buying a permit and, you know, every day for $4 isn't the best use of money. And I think that money can go elsewhere, especially for food or for, you know, just going out trips in my experience. So definitely going about maybe not having a car on campus is a way to go about it. But of course, there's always exceptions for that. But definitely from the apartments close to campus and other apartments that are relatively close, medium distance, you can definitely take public transportation. It'll take a bit more, you know, maybe you have to get up earlier, but it's definitely doable. Especially for me, I live in Yalena, which is maybe 2 miles away from campus, and I can just take the bus there or, you know, take a short walk. It's not terrible. Many students also use electric skateboards or electric scooters to go about. That's great. That's great for it. They're great. They're reliable. They're used on campus, and there's registered bike lanes that have to be used that go about it. So I think they're a really great way to get on campus. I know a lot of parents were also asking about, for example, like 10-minute gaps between classes. That's a great way to go about like getting from class to class. Personally, I made a lot of friends just walking to classes, and that's the best way to. That's the best way that I know people, walking to classes and also getting to know the campus for the first few weeks. That's a great way to go about it. I learned a lot of shortcuts and ways to cut about campus and to really reach other classrooms. Definitely go about it. Just like Dean Mallory is saying, for sure, if you're using a skateboard or scooter, please wear a helmet. I've seen a lot of people wipe out, which is like they fall off them. And they definitely go to the hospital, no helmets. That's definitely a concussion, and it doesn't just affect the student, you know, academically, but also physically. So please be careful. That's my two cents. Any more questions, please?
Any final thoughts about living on campus? Alex, that was very thorough, so I don't know if there's anything much to add. I know some of our other folks just moved off. All right, let's pivot. We got a lot of questions earlier about jobs, internships, research opportunities. Can one or two of you talk about how you found jobs on campus? This will be applicable to the work study questions that we got. This will be applicable to like, I just need a job on campus. And then other folks maybe talk about how you got research opportunities on campus, because those are kind of separate questions.
I can jump in for like the jobs. So UCC is super cool because we have like an app called Handshake, and Handshake will have a bunch of job postings for either just like on-campus jobs. Sometimes they'll have like off-campus jobs as well, but a lot of on-campus jobs you will find there, and that can also include like research opportunities as well, like labs, like lab assistant jobs, roles, even some volunteer positions as well. So I would recommend to check out Handshake. That's an app, or you can Google it online. So it can be a website. And that like has a lot of like job listings, and you can use your work study for these jobs as well. A lot of the jobs like are not work study, like, oh, you have to have work study to apply for this job. But there are some jobs, it's like, oh, we would prefer work study. But once again, it doesn't like diminish you, like, oh no, you don't have work study, you can't like apply for this job. Like there are a bunch of options, and and then also I know like our dining halls are also hiring as well, if you're interested in that. We have a couple orientation leaders on the team who are working there or have worked there, so yeah. And I could pass it off to someone to talk about research or something.
Yeah, if I can put my two cents on research, Definitely for those, especially going into pre-med, research hours are, from what my understanding is, are very important to your resume. And it's something, I'm part of the mentor collective. It's something that I push really hard onto the mentees that I go about, not just their resume building, but also just going about getting research that, so you can present this resume to professors or there's also like there's very eager people that just want to get into the labs, but of course you have to streamline the process. So the way I went about it, and it's very important that I think many students go about it, especially if you're on a pre-med track, it really pushes you to be the best you can and really just, there's one path that you want to take, go for it, shoot for it. So I go about by sitting in front of my classes, the first two rows, two columns, whatever, however the class is structured, right in the middle where the professor can see me. A lot of the professors here, it is an R1 school, so it's a research-oriented school. So there's a lot of professors that have their own research labs, but also teach on the side. I really push my mentees to sit in the front rows of classes, and that's how I got my internships and my lab opportunities. I sat in the front row of my class. I showed eagerness. I showed questions. What's this microbial strain? How does this RNA factor go in with DNA modifications? What's the mutation here? Anything that can go, that shows interest within that subject for the professor is really important, because that professor sees that you're not just a student trying to take their class for maybe, let's say, easy GE, for example, or easy psych class. No, you're actually interested in material. You're actually trying to find out as much as information as you can. So even like after class, even if I understood the assignment, even if I understood what was taught during that class, I would go up to them, ask them, hey, so what would happen if this, if we went about this? What would happen if anything was switched around, for example? And that showed interest to them. Eventually I would ask them, hey, I know this is, I am still an undergrad, but I was wondering if there was any research opportunities within your laboratory that I could partake in. Usually they go about setting up a meeting. Oh yeah, just in case there aren't any in there, I put in if there's any research opportunities in your lab, but if you know any other professors that also want research opportunities for undergraduates, so that they can go about, oh, this student is really interested, they really want to go about it. And usually you have to sit down, see if you really fit into the lab, if it's something that you want to do. I usually volunteer around 5 hours a day, but that's during the summer. Usually your PI, your personal investigator, will go about, they know that you have classes and that you have to get to studying. So really they try to work around your schedule, but you get your research hours. Sometimes they also count as clinical hours for those going into the pre-med track. So that's definitely something that I'm very interested in and definitely helps me on my resume, but also my mentees to push. There's also cold emailing. So there's professors that that allow cold emailing that you can send emails to. I have a template for that for my mentees so that they can partake in it as well. It really helps them, just puts down the stress. They know how to go about it. It's a really simple template. You're just emailing the professor, hey, I'm really interested in undergraduate research. I've taken these classes. I want to partake in this. This is my focus on pre-med. If you have any research opportunities, please, if you could let me know. And usually you'll get, it gets really important for the student to, in high school, you're not really used to rejection, before, but it's definitely important for the student to get really used to now getting rejected, not just, for jobs, but also for internship opportunities. Don't quit, don't give up, please. It's really good to keep going. And that's how I went about it. And, eventually you shoot one, you get one, and you're there, you're fun. It's fun, definitely go about it. There's also emails that go out, or I at least get emails from nanoengineering, my major, which is what, I'm doing this, biomedical device for GE. I need 2 undergraduates that are experienced in this and that, and that have the skills that can back it up. If we could sit down, it's from PhD students or professors that are trying to reach out and gain undergraduate students. It's definitely, yeah. Sorry about that.
Thank you both. Let's pivot into academics a little bit. We got a question about like Revelle's reputation for GEs, but even just talking a little bit about navigating classes, majors, quarter system. Can a couple of you talk a little bit about your academic experience? What was hard? What was manageable? What did you have to adjust?
I think for me, the academic side was a little bit rough, I'm not gonna lie, because I didn't really know how to approach the classes. I didn't know how to what classes would help me, what order should I take them in, all of that jazz. And I wasn't really, you know, fond of the idea of contacting an advisor, especially during the busy times and stuff like that. So I definitely regret that. I think for me, I found a lot of interesting classes. If there was a requirement for specifically for like Revelle, like social studies or stuff like that, I would try to look through the list of classes that would satisfy that class and that requirement and try to find the most interesting one, because as much as we hate to say it, it's better for students to kind of learn and grow if it's something that they're actually interested in. I was in a class that I didn't really enjoy, didn't do really well in it, but it's okay. And it's kind of just working on getting those requirements in and trying to find something that you actually enjoy within it. Finding your own little interest in it as well. As for my major requirements, I'm very excited for them, especially because, you know, I took one class and I fell in love with my major, which is also why I kind of chose to be on the pre-med track after that. And it's just finding like the classes that satisfy those requirements, but finding ones that your student actually enjoys doing rather than like, oh, it's a prereq. If it's a prereq, then you're gonna have to take it, obviously, but find that joy within it. I saw a question earlier on like how to manage that 10 minute walk between classes. It really depends on where your classes is. I would say it's kind of a breeze when it comes to walking to class for certain like areas. I would recommend you using a scooter or like a bike or a skateboard, whatever one you want. I also saw a person on a unicycle if you're really into that. I you know, I walk, I don't do any of that, so I think I haven't really had any issues with the timing. I do speed walk, so that's a plus. But yeah, I think that's my take on academics.
Oh my God, talking about like the 10 minute gap between classes, I feel like that is one of the most popular questions that I've received. And every single time I just say that, yes, you can make it. If it's on campus, doesn't matter if it's on like the two opposite ends of campus, you can make it. You could be like a couple minutes late, but I know like at least from my experience, like the professors or like the other students always understand, like there's always someone walking in late. So like I wouldn't recommend that all the time, but that is something you can definitely make, and it should not be one of your major concerns. And yeah, if you can scooter, of course I would recommend that, but I'm also a walker, I don't use any of those. And okay, talking about like general education requirements, I would say that a lot of students have also taken these classes, and so they're always discussing about them. So one easy way to find them would just be like looking them up on Reddit, or there are also several Discord servers where like they can be specific to your college or like to your major, and students are always talking about classes over there. And I know it can be hard, like when you're an incoming student, to ask about them in person, but as you become like more used to college, make more friends, you should definitely like ask around for what their experience in those classes were. I know sometimes like an experience with a class differs a lot depending on who the professors were. So I would also recommend like maybe looking up professor reviews, or I feel like online, just looking them up and maybe typing like Reddit after that is a good place to start. And for your major classes, I would recommend a similar thing. Like you are supposed to take some of your core classes, but you get a lot of flexibility in what electives you can take. So I would definitely suggest like doing your research and taking the electives that interest you personally and would be really important to whatever field you're trying to be in. And yeah, so once you start doing your core classes, maybe in your major, you can meet more people who are headed in like the same general direction as you. I would recommend talking to classes about them. I remember I just like pull out my notes app. Okay, so you took this class, you liked it? Okay. And then just like save it for later. So yeah, some of your general education requirements, not much flexibility, you have to get through them. So I would just advise that try your best in them. But the ones that you do get an option in, you should do your research and choose something that pertains to your interest.
I just wanted to add a little bit about adjusting to quarter system, because coming from semester system to quarter system, I definitely wanted to make sure that I was able to perform my best even in quarter system. And I think one way that I really tackled that was, I remember my first quarter, I only took 12 units. And I think maybe some people think it's, you know, it's the least amount of units to have active status. But I think it was a really good first step that kind of helped me get an idea of how difficult the classes were going to be, because I was still exploring the campus. I completely, you know, I took the tour, I knew where my buildings were, but I feel like the first quarter, like taking it easy, was definitely a really good step for me personally. And yeah, I think quarter system definitely is a lot more fast paced. You need to be on top of things, really, you know, you need to have a good grip on all your classes. You need to be on top of your homework, your assignments, your projects. And I think a really good tip would be to always attend your TA sessions. But yeah, that's just extra. But yeah, thank you.
We're technically at time, but I know we have a couple big questions still that we haven't really tackled. So I wanna, if we can go maybe five more minutes and tackle a couple things. We haven't really talked about extracurriculars. Like we've talked about jobs and we've talked about research, but what about the social side of being at this university? What are some things that you do for fun, or what are some things that you got involved with besides academics?
Me personally, I'm part of the archery team here at campus. I'm also part of the running club here on campus as well. So I go out on runs with them all the time. I also am part of club activities for like small time robotics. So it really goes out there. There's a lot of like clubs here on campus that you can really join. If you're looking for a boxing club, Muay Thai club, running club, any niche thing that you can think of here, anime, cartoons, just anything. It's really all here on campus. You can check out a website for UCSD clubs. It's all the clubs are listed there. You can go about it, student organizations, they're great. Archery has been a great way for me to de-stress here on campus. You know, it's something for me to get away from my desk, go to practice, shoot a bit, followed closely by rock climbing. I love rock climbing. I'm there all the time. Most of the OLs really know this. It was really fun. I'm always trying to push them to go with me to rock climb. I'm still waiting on James to come with me. So definitely something there. I know we're like known as usually UC socially dead, but no, really go out, meet new people, and go for clubs, you know, go out, explore. There's the beach right there. It's like a mile away. Just go swim, you know, it's find your own social life. It's really fun here. It's not something that's socially dead. So please, yeah.
And we have several large gyms and then some smaller gyms too. So VG, then Steph.
Yeah, and I was also going to say, I understand it can be intimidating sometimes, like actually like reaching out to clubs. So Revelle College is also like a good place to start. We always have some kind of events going on, and that is a great place to meet people. And like, they're also like themed sometimes. So like, you can always find something that interests you and then find more people over there who you can be friends with, and then through them find more opportunities like on campus to participate in something. Like Revelle College has like events, like if you like arts and crafts, if you like dancing, if you like anything. Yeah, so I would say Revelle College is a nice place to start, but I would also recommend going to info nights of clubs. I feel like the club activity is like really happening like during the first few weeks of fall quarter, and I would recommend that everyone tries to get to know more clubs.
I know Adalia put this in the chat, but during the first few weeks of each quarter, I think, especially during the very first quarter of the year, we have something called Club Rush. And on Library Walk, you will see an array of just tents of all the clubs on campus. And even throughout the year, there will be people setting up tents and being like, hey, join this club. And if you have an identity, if you have an interest on anything, quite literally anything, there is a Costco club on campus. Like, if you like that, if you want to, you know, explore that, you are very much welcome to. And there is probably a club for that. There is a Dungeons and Dragons club as well. And I have just been using my first year to kind of make a list on which ones I want to join for next year. There is like quite literally anything and everything that you can imagine. There is a club for that. And the people there are so awesome. And it's just so nice to see people with the same interests go so like wild and like happy. And they're like, oh my gosh, you like this too? Come join the club. And it's just an awesome atmosphere.
And we're hitting a time boundary. Can one of you just quickly talk a little bit about feeling safe on campus, walking around at night, like especially when daylight savings time happens, like you're getting out of class, it's dark.
I got you for this one. When I first visited campus, my mom was like, oh my gosh, there's a bunch of trees. What if you're walking here late at night? And I was like, okay, fair point. But when I actually got on campus and did my, like, you know, overnights at Geisel, where I'm staying till like 2, 3 a.m., which is okay for the parents out there. Like, you walk back, it's super well lit. Like, I literally think my tuition goes to paying the electricity bill at UC San Diego. Like, it's so crazy how much, like, light there is on campus. And if you still don't feel safe, we have our, like, call boxes that, like, if you press, like, it's like they're blue call boxes. You press the button, and you will be connected to like a dispatcher in like 2 or 3 seconds, I think. And it takes a picture of like your entire surroundings. So totally safe on that spot. And also, if you are walking back from Geisel at 2 or 3 a.m., there are like our campus security officers, our CSOs, that can walk you back. They can bike you back. They can drive you back, depending where you are. Just call them. They will be there. So you are safe. Your students are safe. I feel safe. So there you go.
Thank you, Adalia. Let's end on a high note, a question that came out like an hour ago. Best part of Revelle College. What do you like best about Revelle? Let you all answer, and that'll be like our closing question. There will still be questions in the chat. We can still kind of type some answers, but I want to make sure we go on break before the next presentation. So best part of Revelle, according to you, not the cookie cutter book answer. What's your best part of Revelle?
Definitely the community at Revelle. There's lots of events and lots of people around. And I've made a lot of my close friends here on campus just from the community at Revelle. I really enjoy it.
I'll let you all take this one, so you can all say your version.
I gotta echo Alex there. The community at Revelle, just from living on campus with my suite mates and then joining orientation. Like, I'm literally like, this is my second year doing orientation. I have like an orientation like family now. We do like bigs and littles for orientation. Shout out Alex and Steph. They are my littles, so they're doing so good. It's reflective of me, but it's okay. But I love the community and the people here, honestly. So yeah.
Definitely. I mean, that's definitely a really good answer. I would say just having the opportunity to meet people from different parts of the world and, you know, making friends through that is a really special thing. And also, I think Revelle has really pushed me to become a better version of myself in a lot of different ways that I'm really grateful for.
Echoing everyone, the community, it's so awesome. Revelle in and of itself is kind of small, so everyone is like meeting each other, like bumping into each other, and it's just like an awesome time. Specifically the GE for Hume brings a lot of people together. I've known so many people from Hume who are struggling together, and that just kind of makes everything worthwhile and makes you feel like, oh god, at least I'm not alone. Definitely, I think the best part of Revelle is in fact the community. You do not have to worry. At some point, your student will make friends, whether they like it or not. and it's just an awesome experience. Everyone is so welcoming. And yeah, I think, yeah.
Yeah, echoing everyone, basically the same thing. Like, I love about Revelle is how much support I feel at all times. Like, I know if I need something, someone is going to be here for me. And that is definitely something that all the orientation leaders and other leaders around Revelle College always like insist on, that we are here for you. And I really like that about Revelle College.
Jumping in one last thing there, our staff as well. Our staff is so amazing. So shout out to everyone who's taken the time today to be on this call. Especially shout out to James, who used to be an academic advisor as well. He literally helped me like switch my major. So James is always there. We call him Bessie James, but yeah.
I wish I could say like I didn't pay you to say that, but technically I did, since you're my staff. But you're all very kind. And you're also very kind for taking the time to talk to all of our family members. I really appreciate it. If you can stick around for maybe 5 more minutes, if there's anything else you wanted to finish up in the Q&A. But I do want to send everyone on break and get a chance to reset. We'll come back at 11:35 or in 10 minutes. I'll put a slide back up. I've turned the chat back on too, if you want to start talking and engaging again. And thanks for all of you that submitted questions. And thank you very much, orientation leaders, our Revelle students, our amazing Revelle students, for sharing a little bit of your story. These students will see your students next month. And yeah, have a good day, OLs. We'll go on break now. We'll see you in about 10 minutes for our last presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, bringing us back. I know that was a quicker break, but I wanted to give time for the students to answer all those questions. All right, I'm gonna stop sharing now. It is my great pleasure to bring us into the final portion of our orientation. I know sometimes I look at these Zoom calls, I'm like, 3 hours, that's really long. And also when we get to the sections, I'm like, we don't have enough time for Janet. I'm really honored to introduce Janet Lim. She's our program assistant. She's a staff member here in Revelle and has been here longer than I have. And I would say that I witness every day how much our students connect with her. And that's, I hope, a theme that you pass down to your students, to connect with the staff, because there's people here that really do care and will go above and beyond to support you. And Janet is one of those people. And she also will go above and beyond to support you as our family members. And so I'm going to spotlight Janet and let you share the screen and take it away.
Great. Thank you so much. I'm going to share my screen here. Okay. James, is that working?
It just popped up. Yep.
Great. Great. Awesome. Well, good morning, everyone. I'm so happy that you took the time to spend the morning with us to find out how to support your student and find out how we support your student. But this last half an hour is all about you and how we can support you. And we have several different options for you on campus and in Revelle College that help connect us to you. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I am the program assistant for Revelle College. I've worked for Revelle for about 15 years in two different eras. I worked before I had kids, stopped out to raise kids, came back when kids decided to go to out-of-state college and I needed to work more. So I came back to Revelle, thankfully, as the program assistant. So I get to work on orientation. I get to advise a few student organizations, which I love. I get to work on our social media team, which is actually really, really funny considering I didn't know anything about social media when I started working here, but I'm learning a lot from the students and it's been really fun. And I learn a new word every day from our students. So it's pretty interesting. But I also am someone who has two grown children that have both graduated from college. So my oldest son graduated in 2020 during COVID. And my other son graduated in 2023. So as a mom of two sort of recent college graduates, I have been where you are today. I went to the parent orientations. I remember the feelings that you're probably feeling about how are we going to do this. I don't know where you are in your journey, if this is your first student, if this is your second, if you're about to have an empty nest. I have two, so I've witnessed or experienced the first student going away and the empty nest, so I can talk about both those things. But it does seem like yesterday that I was standing in their residence hall rooms, you know, saying goodbye and leaving them. One was in Oregon and one was all the way in New York City. So it was very, very hard to let them go. But I have to say they're both fine. They're good. They're functioning, happy, successful humans in the world. So it does work out after all. Even though all the things I'm going to tell you, you know, these are just things that you just have to deal with in you when you let your students go to college. So, and I do understand too that a lot of students live at home or they may live close by, and that's really nice. I didn't have that luxury. They wanted to go far and create adventures on their own. So today I get to talk to you about campus resources and support, coping with transition, what worked for me. And then we have a very unique and amazing program in Revelle called the Revelle College Family Love Note Program. So I'll close my quick presentation this morning talking about how you can connect with your student through our Love Note Program. So this is, I'm going to talk a little bit about my boys. These are my two boys. You know, it also seems like yesterday that they were this age. They were, you know, 5 and 3 going to Padre games, and now look at them. This is just last year when my youngest son graduated from college. So before you know it, as you have experienced, they go from cute little darlings to adults, and it goes like that. And so that's just kind of amazing how we are experiencing this life, and we're at another stage. So this is my son Cameron on the left at St. John's University commencement in May 2023. He earned his degree in sports management. He did an internship in sports management. He came home from that internship and says, I don't want to work in sports management. It's like, oh my God, really? Okay, no problem. Now he thinks he might want to work in real estate. So that's where he's heading right now, studying for a real estate exam. The one on the bottom right is my son, Brady, who graduated in 2020 during the pandemic. So we watched him graduate on television, on a live stream from University of Oregon. Very heartbreaking for a mom and a dad and to go through, and for him too. He was sitting right next to us in our living room. He's now happily living in Las Vegas, working as an assistant golf pro. He graduated with a degree in English. We thought he would be a journalist. COVID took care of that because he wanted to be a sports journalist. So when he graduated from University of Oregon in COVID, there was no sports, if you may remember that. So he had to pivot, and he got a job in golf, and he didn't know that was a thing he could do, and he absolutely loves it. He's very successful and very happy. So those are my boys. And I just wanted to kind of talk about two things. I'll talk about my personal experience, but also how it intersects with Revelle College. So you have heard already this morning that Revelle College and the college system is really the secret sauce of UC San Diego. And I am biased, but I also know it's true because I've been around for so long that Revelle College is very special. Our students are amazing. Our staff is amazing. And we get up every day and go to work because we want to help students. I'm sure you've heard that over and over again this morning. So we're a small college environment within a large research university. And this is a large research university, and it's getting larger by the day. So, you know, we're welcoming in about 1,375 new students out of 34,000 incoming students. But those 1,375 students are our Revelle students. And so we are focused on them. No student is invisible. I promise you that, especially if they get involved and they reach out for help. We are a very dedicated staff. We care is in our value statement. I'm going to show my email and my phone number several times in this presentation, and I am not at all lying when I say you can call me and I will help you. Because I have been where you are, I know how important it is to be able to pick up a phone and talk to someone who will listen and understand and connect you with the right resources. We'll do our best to help whenever we can. And Revelle has our own programs to help students. You know, some of the students that you just listened to in the panel are orientation leaders. They have participated in Revelle specific activities, and that has given them kind of an entree into the greater campus and involvement in the greater campus. So we help students if they get stuck. This time last year, I told all the families, if your student needs something, please tell them to come in and say hi to us. And if they need help, we can help them. And I actually had a student come in last year, and he's like, my mom told me to come in and say hi because I don't know. And I can't remember exactly what the issue was, but they said, I don't know how to do whatever. I said, oh my gosh, I'm so glad that you got that message because you're here and let's help you figure it out. And so we did. So we have residence hall specific, you probably already heard this, student activities, academic advising, academic programs, and orientation. And orientation is really the best thing because they're going to feel so great after orientation. So UC San Diego also has an amazing parent and family programs office. I imagine that some of you have already engaged with our parent portal, our online resource that is connecting you with the services and programs on campus that you're probably really interested in hearing about right now, which is financial aid, you know, admissions, all the things that you're, you know, student health insurance. That's something that we get a lot of calls about. So parent and family programs is kind of your stop for all things parents. So we support parents in Revelle, but you also have a full parent and family programs office dedicated to you as well. So if you're someone like me, I like to get involved in things. The first thing I wanted to know was, how do I get involved in campus? Because I really want to stay connected. So our Parent and Family Programs office has the Triton Family Ambassadors Program. You can connect with prospective parents and you can be on panels, provide support for families that are coming in. You can connect your professional development, you know, your professional opportunities to our students if that's something that you're interested in. So there's a QR code here on my presentation if you're interested in looking at the form to be connected with the Triton Family Ambassador Program. You can go ahead and look at that QR code. They also have a very great website if you want to just like look up parent and family programs through the just through our campus websites. They also have Triton Family Connection newsletters. I find the newsletters to be very helpful because they do offer a lot of information that you might need throughout the year and that you can just kind of store away as a nugget of information to ask your student about, maybe on a phone call. So if you want to sign up for your Triton Family newsletters, your student has to add your name to their Triton Link portal, and then we can go ahead and grab your email and send you the newsletter. One program that is one of my favorite programs, probably the most favorite program for me personally, is Family Weekend. And that's an opportunity for you to come back to Revelle College and UC San Diego and reconnect with everyone and see your student after they've been here for about a month. They've been here about a month. So if you haven't already registered, the registration is open for Family Weekend. It's free. It's in October. They have had an enormous amount of registrations, a huge response to their first registration being open. So I think everything is pretty full, but they are actively seeking new presentations and trying to expand the current workshops and programs that they had offered so that we can involve more people. Revelle College has an activity during Family Weekend, so look for information about that, and you can reconnect with us. And you know, a lot of people sign up for Family Weekend, but frankly, when I did, we went to Family Weekend, we connected with the campus a little bit, but then we just wanted to spend time with our sons. So we went to football games, we went shopping, we toured, you know, we did all the things. So you can do both. You can connect with campus, and then also connect with your students outside of campus. It's really, really fun. I, if you can make it work, I would highly suggest you trying to come for Family Weekend. It's great. Okay, so during move-in, I know that most of your students will probably be living on campus, but a lot of students do not live on campus. But if you are moving students in to Revelle College, Revelle College is doing something new this year. We are sponsoring a Revelle family lounge. So speaking from experience, during move-in, it's very hectic. It's a very emotional time. Students are feeling nervous. Parents are feeling nervous. Everybody's excited. There's a lot of opinions about where to put things and how you should organize. Like I said, oh, I think you should put your I think you should put your computer here, and I think you should put your Kleenex box here. You know, I was very much like I wanted to impart to my sons how they should organize their residence hall all in like the 20 minutes that we had to unload our stuff. So it can be very emotional. It can also be highly emotionally charged. So families, take advantage of this opportunity to just sneak away. Let your student kind of do their thing, meet their new roommates, you know, kind of just get used to their space on their own. You can just sneak away, come to our lounge, which is in the Revelle community. It's in our commuter lounge, which is right in the residence hall community. Take a break, have a cup of coffee, have a muffin, have a snack. We will have some staff hosted hours. So if you want to talk with staff, I put the dates of the staff hosted hours where we'll actually have staff from Revelle and possibly other campus departments there to just kind of connect with. But it is a great place for you to just kind of relax during move-in, which I said can be very tiring, very hectic. It's like somebody's got to park the car, somebody's got to unload the car, get the car back. It's just like it's a lot in about an hour. So don't hesitate to take advantage of that. But I do recommend that you try to give your student a little break and let them kind of just be by themselves for a little bit during move-in, and then you can come back, you know, refreshed and ready to go. So that's something that is there for you from Revelle College. And this is unique to Revelle College. I believe at this point only Revelle does this one. So we're pretty proud of it. We're very excited to do it for you. Okay. So after they start, what now? I just wanted to talk to you about what worked for me. Revelle has been so great to me as a staff person, and they have allowed me this opportunity to talk to you and give you information as to what worked for me to kind of, just like do this college thing without as much stress as it could create. And I have lots of things to impart and lots of stories to tell that I'm telling you because I think you should not do what I did. So that's what I'm doing. So what worked for me? All right. So the first thing I really like doing is becoming connected. Like I said, I love to get involved. I love to like know what's going on. I always want to know what's going on. So one of the ways that you can get connected to campus right away is to follow our social media accounts. So I know some of you may or may not be social media people, and that's fine. But if you wanted to just like follow our account, you could just look at things that are going on. We have several accounts that I think would be very helpful to you. You don't have to interact with the accounts. You don't have to know how to post anything. You don't have to comment back or anything, but you can just kind of follow us and see what's going on. So we have All Things Revelle, which is our Revelle specific account. So that's like the general account for Revelle. And we post pictures three times a week. We post first generation student spotlights. We post wellness posts. And then we also post a lot of flyers and things that are happening on campus on our story. So this is a good way to get information about Revelle and the campus, like what's going on. So you might see that there's a job opening or a club meeting or something that's going on. Revelle Residence Life has their own Instagram, and they post a lot of things about, you know, deadlines and things that are happening and things that students need to pay attention to. The Parent and Family Programs Office has an Instagram account. So they're constantly posting. Housing and Dining, obviously very, very important to you, knowing what's going on at Dining. And then the Career Center. You know, Career Center offers stuff from the beginning when they first step on campus all the way to the end when they're graduating with us. So the Career Center is a good one to follow too. Okay, so on the bottom, I wrote caution. Parent Facebook pages can be tricky. All right, first embarrassing story that I have to tell you this. It's painful to bring it up every year when I bring this up, but I have to tell you about these parent Facebook groups. Okay, so there are lots of Facebook groups that parents create that are not official. They're UCSD class of 2028, I guess it would be if you have a first year student. So 2028. So you get on these class of 2028 Facebook pages. It's all people like yourself. And there's lots of information flying around. Lots of it is not even accurate. It's just things people have heard. So you kind of have to take information on these Facebook pages with a grain of salt. But this is what I did, and I don't want you to do this because it was awful. So what I did, so my son Cameron was, he was at St. John's University. COVID happened. He came home, like a lot of people did. So he came home. He spent a year and a half doing college remotely. So he went back to the campus as a junior. So 1.5 years later, he went back to campus. So we took him to campus. It was very different. So like all the fun places that he liked, not all, most of the fun places that he liked going to were either different or closed. So like he had this special food court and this special campus restaurant all closed, which was kind of upsetting to him. A lot of his friends who he knew and met first year, they were gone. They either didn't come back or they went to another university or they had moved on. So he felt really weird coming back, and he didn't really expect it. And I didn't expect it either, his dad and I. So we were kind of managing the emotions of like, ooh, I don't know about this. Okay, so that's one thing. So we drop him off. He has a new roommate. He's in an apartment style residence, which is new to him. Different location on campus. Everything was new. So he had a look on his face that I cannot just, I mean, moms and dads know the look when your kid is like, I don't know about this. So here we are. He's got that look like he had when he was a first year student, and we had to just leave him. So we're like, okay, well, all right, good luck. Bye. You know? So I was very upset by it. I didn't know what to do. I went home. I was very, very anxious. You know, I was still working at home. So I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just the kind of person, I'm just going to take care of things. I'm just going to get them off. So let me look on this Facebook page. So I get on the Facebook page. I read some posts, and I'm like, I'm going to post. Hey parents, my name is blah, blah, blah. And my son, Cameron Lynn, who lives at Founders Hall, room 175. Don't do that. Do not do that. Was when we dropped him off, he was very disappointed by the state of campus. And I think he's really depressed and I'm really worried about him. And, you know, I'm sure I threw in some other stuff, but it was, I mean, the first time I've ever done this, the first time I ever posted on a Facebook page was that. And I sent it off and I'm like, I feel better. Okay. So probably 45 minutes after that, I get a phone call from my son, Cameron. He's like, Mom, did you post on Facebook? I said, yeah, why? And he goes, oh my God. He's like, my new roommate's mom called him to see how I was doing because you put my name and our room number on the Facebook post. So of course I was like, oh my God, oh my God. And I'm like, oh, it'll be fine. I'll take it down. Nobody reads those things anyway. He's like, I don't know, Mom. Oh my God, I can't believe you did this. He's like, I've never really been mad at you, but I'm really mad at you right now. And I'm like, I'm really, really sorry. So I took down the Facebook post, calmed him down a little bit. I'm like, oh my God, you know. So we hung up. And then I don't know what came over me, but I decided to send an email to the residence life department because in that phone call, he also mentioned how there were some people in his apartment doing some maintenance and they had found mold in the bathroom. Okay. That's their deal. Whatever, they'll fix it. But I felt like I had to send an email to the residence hall. So I fired up this email about how they didn't have enough activities for my student and like things are so different. And I just don't know if he's going to adjust. And I think he's a little depressed. I used the depressed word again, which he wasn't depressed, by the way. He was, that's just what I saw. And by the way, there's mold in the bathroom. So about, I don't know, another hour later, he calls me again, Mom, what did you send to the residence life office? Somebody just knocked on our door and was checking on me because they thought I wasn't doing well. What are you doing? And I'm like, oh my God. I said, no, I sent him an email about the mold in the bathroom, which was literally the last line of this very long email. And he's like, oh my God, Mom. He goes, you know, I thought I was doing better. I didn't know if I wanted to stay at first, but then I was kind of getting better. But now I don't know because I'm really embarrassed and I think I want to come home. And I'm like, no. Just stay. I said, this is me. I'm so sorry. So it took a long time for us to get over that. And I really, really, really cannot emphasize enough that you have to be careful about these emotions that we're feeling. So that's just a cautionary tale. Don't do what I did. All right. Next thing that's part of it, okay, is establish a communication plan with your student. All right. A lot of students talk to their families every single day. I hear it when my students come into my office. And that's perfectly fine if that's what you two have agreed on. Some students really want that. Some students really don't want that. My kids, both of them said, you know what? We want a weekly call that's planned at a certain time because we're busy. We're in class, we may be playing basketball, we may be at the gym, we may be at the library, we may be, you know, whatever, taking a shower. And so we don't want to have to pick up the phone all the time. And ironically enough, my son, my oldest one, is visiting us right now from Las Vegas. And I brought up this morning and I said, did you like that communication plan? And he said, oh yeah. He says, oh yeah. He goes, like, nobody answers the phone anymore anyway. So he goes, I just really prefer everything to be planned out. So we had a weekly call. It worked out great. They were expecting it. We were expecting it. You know, my husband had his list of questions. You know, it was a very long call. But one thing that I learned early on is like trying to seek first to understand, then be understood. Like, for example, you know, depending on what level of access you're requesting, you might be able to see some things that they're doing and you might make assumptions like about their life. And then you just accuse them of things like, did you take care of this? Or are you studying enough? You know, instead of asking first how things are going. And then if you have a concern, then you could bring it up. But it's always, I always found it's better to just ask first, ask a lot of questions first, and then ask them how they're doing instead of, you know, coming in with a list of like, you know, things that you think are not going well. I don't know if that makes sense, but it works well for us. And then my favorite thing to spark a conversation with my kids was like, tell me more. Just tell me more about all the things that you're doing. Because, you know, I don't know about you, but my kids are kind of like very different from me. Like they're men of few words. So they don't share as much as I obviously would share. So I had to kind of leave open-ended questions so that they would share more. You know, and they laugh at me still today. I always want to know everybody's name. what's your roommate's name? Oh, like, who's this person that you go to these games with? What's his name? You know, or what's her name? And then they're like, why do you care about the names? I'm like, I don't know. I just do. So anyway, it's good to just, you know, keep it open-ended. All right. This one is interesting. Okay, so we all know, you know, this is especially speaking to parents who are empty nesters. Okay, because if you have more kids at home, you're busy, you're still taking care of kids at home. If this is an empty nest that you're facing, things are going to be different. It's well known that like empty nest syndrome is a thing, and it's hard on us. It's very hard on us. So what I suggest, if you haven't already thought of this, and I'm not about to tell you how to live your life, I'm just saying this is what worked for me. Developing new interests or taking on a project is the way that I found helped me cope best. So I didn't do the crazy mom thing that I just described about the Facebook pages and the firing off emails. So when our second son, Cameron, left, I was like, I need a project. So we were lucky enough that we could do this. We remodeled our bathroom. So my husband and I, this is actual pictures of our guest bathroom. So my husband and I demolished the bathroom. We remodeled the bathroom. And it was actually a really fun project for both of us to kind of reconnect. And we had some, I mean, we have a great marriage, but you know how you bicker. And he's like, hey, we put that floor together and we didn't even argue. So it was fun. It was a fun project for both of us to reconnect and to fill time with emptiness. Because when you're a mom or a dad, I mean, that's your identity. I mean, I for me anyway, it's like, I'm mom first, everything second. So it was hard. It was hard when they left. Okay. The next thing is like, if you can, is represent UC San Diego. They have a lot of merchandise in the bookstore that's kind of fun to buy. The reason why I do that is I always love being involved in stuff, but I kind of found it like created like a common interest. Like if you run into somebody like at Target and you're like, oh, your son goes to UCSD, so does mine. And then it's kind of fun for you to talk about your kids and UC San Diego and your experience. So that's kind of just something fun that I like doing. And then this is our final fun thing that you can take advantage of. When you leave your student or when your student starts college here at Revelle. Okay, so we have what's called a Revelle Family Love Note program. So during week 5 of the quarter, Revelle College will send love notes from you, and I'll tell you how you can write these love notes directly to the student with your words that you write now. You write it now. So some universities do it during orientation, like when we would have, if you were on campus during an in-person orientation, you would write a letter, we would take it, we would hand it to the student during week 5. We know that now the world is different, everything's a lot more virtual. So we have offered an amazing virtual opportunity to do these love notes. So we will be sending you a Google form in an email in the next 2 weeks that again explains the love note program. And it just is it's a form, you fill it out, who's it from, you know, and then there's a section there, just write your note. And then we take your notes and we print them on special student designed Revelle love note letterhead. And we organize them. And then during week 5, which is typically a very stressful time for our students because there's midterms, the middle of the quarter, there's a lot of things going on. It's really nice for them to get some love from family during that time. So we deliver our love notes through our resident assistants if they live on campus, if they live off campus in their own apartment or dwelling, or if they live at home. So even if they're right there in your same house, we can still send the love notes that you write this summer. So it's a really amazing program. If you have any questions about it, just send me an email and I'll answer the questions, but you will be receiving an email from Revelle Orientation in the next couple of weeks that has the link to the love notes. All right. And so that's it for my presentation. I know it's a lot about my experience, but I am hoping to offer you support and offer you some, you know, cautionary tales of what didn't work for me, but also what did work for me. Because our students, they change and we change and we all have to change together. And what we think is going to happen to them usually doesn't happen to them, but it's not bad. It's usually better. So if you need support, don't hesitate to contact us anytime. All of our emails are there if you're interested in taking a photo of this, or we'll send them in the email as well. But again, my name is Janet Lim. I'm the program assistant. I will see you at Family Weekend, and I am available by email or by phone call anytime if you want to reach out and talk. I'm happy to do that. After this presentation, if you are available to hang on this call, I'm happy to stay and just talk to you about your kids. I'd love to hear about your kids. I'd love to answer questions. I'd love to offer support. So I'm here for you all year, but especially now for the next hour. So I think that's it.
Thank you so much, Janet. The Google form with the love notes will be going out very soon. We just want to make sure that we have it activated and we get all the right things in place. We are at the end of our orientation now. I dropped an assessment in the chat if you want to give us any feedback about the program. The question I always get is, when will the recording be available? It takes Zoom a little while to process, so I'm hoping to send it out to you all next week, and maybe we can get the love notes up and running next week too, so that way we can send you one big email with everything. Again, I hope that you continue to...
Sorry, James.
I hope you can continue to interact with the new Family Orientation Hub and see those recordings and see those presentations and stay in touch with us. I appreciate you coming out on a Friday morning. I know many of you are working, have other things going on. We're looking forward to meeting your students and supporting them, and they're going to have a great time here in Revelle. And they are really amazing. They make our job amazing. So it is a privilege and an honor to work with you, and an even bigger privilege and honor to work with your students. They're in good hands here. And we look forward to being good partners with you. Have a good Friday. If you're going to stick around for the hangout brown bag lunch, you can stay here. The chat's back on. We'll have cameras on and folks can hang out for a little bit and connect with each other. But wishing you all a happy Friday and a good weekend. Bye.
Hi, everyone. I don't know if anyone's hanging around, but I'm happy to answer questions and talk. You can either put it in the chat or you can unmute and ask questions, whatever you'd like to do.
Hi, Janet.
Yes, yes.
I'm Kurt Wilson.
Hi, Kurt. And
Glendora, I'm actually Revelle 1991.
Oh my gosh.
And my son will be the third generation on campus. I was the first one to graduate from UC San Diego, but my uncle actually did his Marine Corps marksmanship training when it was Camp Matthews in 1963.
Oh my gosh.
You made sure to tell us that when my son got accepted.
Oh, that's amazing.
Anyway, I wanted to thank you for sharing your experience and, you know, what not to do, because, yeah, you know, I tend to get that way too, and a little panicky, and, you know, my son, who's floating around behind me somewhere, you know, he's not irresponsible, but he's not terribly responsible either. He's in that mid stage. So, you know, just thank you again for sharing that. And, you know, I really appreciate that.
Oh, thank you, Kurt. Well, yeah, you know, it's interesting because they will surprise us, you know, they will.
Sure.
Like preschool, there's a lot of things going on, and they, you know, I noticed that my kids didn't want to talk about a lot of stuff like during high school when they were kind of getting accepted and moving into the, you know, just taking care of things to get to college. You know, it's like, did you do this? Did you, you know, so there was a lot of checking in on them. And I felt, you know, that's just what we do. And so when they get to college, we kind of have to switch how we're thinking about it. But it's very hard for us as parents to step back and not do the same thing we've always done our whole life.
Yes.
You know, I have so many cringe moments, and it's just embarrassing, and like I said, slightly traumatizing to bring it up every year, but it's worth hearing because we do have to remind ourselves that things are changing. So, is your student your only or first?
Yes, he's an only child,
Your
so
only. Okay, so you're
yeah.
sending off and empty nests.
Yes, yep, all of that all at once. So
That's a hard one. That's hard. So the empty nest thing, I felt like some people really love it. I was terrified of it, to be honest.
I'm not looking forward to it, to be honest with you. It's going to be lonely, but you know, he's only we live in Glen, I live in Glendora, so he's only 2 hours away at most. So
That's nice.
you know, and I'm glad that he chose UC San Diego because he was thinking about Oregon. He really kind of wanted to go to Oregon, and I said, yeah, there, I can't fly, so it's like, yeah, that's not going to work well.
It's a long drive, and the weather, you know, there's so much weather uncertainty
Yes.
with the traveling. Yeah, it actually took longer to get to Eugene, Oregon than it did get to New York City
Yeah.
because of the driving and the flight. Yeah, so anyway, I hear you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think the weather was the one that finally tipped him in the balance because it was 100 degrees here and he was outside playing basketball and he goes, I like the heat.
Nice.
It's like, okay. Yeah, you'll get.
You know, when he comes to La Jolla, he's going to have to definitely bring a hoodie.
Yeah. Well, yes and no. We've taken a couple of visits down there and you know, I told him I think we were going and I said, yeah, oh gosh, the high is gonna be 75 today. And he's like, oh, I'm gonna have to take a jacket. And honestly, I just laughed for about 30 minutes. And we got down there. This was in June, and we finally wended our way down to the Cabrillo National Monument, and we went to the tide pools because that's where we usually go when we're in San Diego. And we're getting into the car, and he goes, this is like the hottest 71 degrees I've ever felt. It's like, that's humidity for you. So it's almost always shorts weather in San Diego.
Almost always,
Yes.
almost. Yes.
Sweatshirt, yeah, you'll need a jacket. And you know, sometimes it does get a little cold, but it's not like up here where,
Oh, no.
no, when it's, I mean, I always tell them 55 degrees in San Diego, that's great. 55 degrees in Glendora, you're freezing. So, yeah.
All part of the experience, right? That they figure out what works for them.
Yes.
Yeah, it's very exciting. It's a
Yes.
very exciting process. It's just once you get over your thing, which then it's exciting. So,
Yes.
oh my goodness. Well, I'm so glad that I'm glad that you've stayed on. You know, it's hard to let go.
Yeah,
Yeah.
it is. So.
So does anyone else have any questions? I'm happy to answer. I'd love to talk about your kids, hear about your kids.
Janet, I'm going to be coming in from Hong Kong
Oh,
to drop
okay.
off my daughter. And she is at the moment a commuter student because we were waitlisted for housing. So, in addition to the whole, them going off to college, I have a certain level of anxiety about how her freshman year will be impacted because she's off campus and she's not from California. So she has a comfort level with America, but she is, we don't have any family, and how will she integrate? And will it, her whole freshman experience is not what I guess either of us were envisioning it would look like. So,
Right.
any words of advice there?
Absolutely, absolutely. First of all, she's not alone. There's plenty of students in her that have her ex the same experience coming here from another country and actually not living on campus. So I understand what you're saying. I would say the key for her, I don't know what kind of person she is, if she enjoys getting involved or if she likes to stay back a little bit first, get to know things. But I'd say that like the living off campus experience can be really great. You have your own private space and there's a lot of things that are really great about it. But you do have to get involved in things to make the friends because you will make friends in class, but it's a large, usually the first and second year, the classes are a little larger. So it's a little bit harder to make friends in a large classroom, but you can. So I would suggest if she's that type of person for her to get involved right away in something that she's interested in. So that's something where that'll keep her on campus beyond the classes. because it's really easy for commuter students to go to class and then just go back to their apartment, you know? And then they're kind of like, well, now what? I'm back at my apartment. I guess I'll study. And they study. Maybe they'll watch Netflix or something, you know. But it's like, it's really great for them to find an interest that they can explore on campus so that they stay on campus and enjoy the community of campus. So what does she like to do for fun?
She's very, most of her interests derive from relationships, which is why her staying off campus, as a parent, makes me anxious, because when she gets to know people is when she gets inspired or motivated to participate in stuff.
Right, right.
And therefore, you know, as a commuter student, are there lounge areas in like Revelle residence buildings, etc., where they can also access?
Absolutely. Yeah, we do have a Revelle commuter lounge right in the middle of our community. It's right there. And that's where commuter students can come and hang out. We have a microwave if they want to heat up food. We have couches. We have study carrels. We have computers, maybe. And then we have, you know, we have some booths set up so they can sit with friends and study or eat or hang out. So yeah, a lot of students really enjoy our commuter lounge. And then there's other commuter spaces around campus too. So just because she's in Revelle doesn't mean that she can't utilize the commuter spaces in other parts of campus. So most of the other colleges have a commuter space too, which is very similar. And then there's a big commuter space in the main central part of campus in our Price Center, which is kind of like our student union area. They have a big commuter space too there. And so it's a really good place for her to kind of just, you know, especially in between classes, you know, just go and have a place to relax, put her bag down, you know, get some food and just even like take a little snooze. You know, there's plenty of people snoozing in there. we bought new furniture this year, so it's nice and comfy and it's nice and clean and there's nice ottomans and we all sat in the chairs. So they're all comfy. So there's a lot of places for her to just relax on in between classes. But I cannot say it enough that she's definitely going to have to reach out to and find involvement opportunities. So like relationships are, you know, I love it to hear that she likes relationships. That's fantastic, because that's what the clubs are all about, honestly, is creating relationships with other students and then having a common goal to get something done. So I think it's, or just have fun. You know, there's plenty of clubs. Like, for example, one of my students who's from India, she lives on campus, but she is, you know, she's here by herself, you know. She joined a roller skating club. So they roller skate on this basketball court outside. They reserve the court and they have skates and they just roller skate on this basketball court every week. It's great exercise. They're laughing. There's music. They're having a blast. So she joined that last year and now she's in leadership of the roller skating club. And then she had never participated really in watching American sports. She's like, oh my gosh, I think I really like baseball. So she is a huge fan of Triton baseball. So she's gotten all of her friends to like go to baseball games with her. So through that, she has joined our student kind of like pep club. They don't call it that, but it's like a pep club. It's called Triton Tide. So they're the group of students who go to all the games and they get some fans hyped up at games and they do the giveaways and all the goofy fun things. So now she's in that too. She's like, I would never have done that when I first walked on campus. So she's doing two very, what she says are very American things, roller skating and baseball. And she's having a blast. So, and she's also very relational. So she's just like, I want to just meet people and have fun. So there's a lot of great things to do.
Thank you.
I'm gonna also offer if she, your daughter, doesn't know what to do when she gets here and she's like, I don't know where to go, have her just come into our office and check in with us and we can sit down and go through all the things that are available, because it's very overwhelming. There's a lot of stuff available.
Thank you.
You're so welcome. I mean, there's like 600 clubs. So that can be very overwhelming to someone who's like, you know, we say, what do you want to do? I don't know. It's like, well, you have to, you know, this is the parent. What do you want to do? I don't know. How do you not know? You know, it's like, I don't know. So anyway, I'm happy to help her if she gets stuck. So I look forward to that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Johanna. My daughter is going to be going into, she just found out, Discovery.
Oh, great.
And she has, I put this in the Q&A earlier, she has, she plays a couple different Chinese musical instruments that she wants to bring with her. Ooh. And I was wondering about if, I heard that some of the dorms in Revelle had like practice rooms, but I'm not sure if that's true or if it is true, which ones, and if she's not in one of them, if she would have access to it, or if she would have access to a space to practice on campus somewhere.
That is a really great question. I'm not an expert in that, but I do know in, so all the residence halls are very close together. Mm-hmm. So what's available to one is available to all, you know, with the spaces in the residence halls. Okay. So James is gonna sign off now, y'all. So it'll be me. I'll be here for you until 1 o'clock. but there are music practice rooms in Argo Hall, which is right next to Discovery Hall. And there is a reservation process for that. So if you want to reserve one of the practice rooms, you just have to, I don't know how to do it exactly, but I'm happy to look it up and find out. You just reserve a space and then you can go ahead and practice. Yeah. So that's great. Now, does she want to play those instruments in with a group?
I think so. I think she's hoping to join. I think there's a traditional Chinese music orchestra or something.
Oh, that's, I would not doubt that. I wouldn't doubt that.
Yeah, I think she's planning to join. She plays three different instruments. So yeah, I know she wants to keep playing them, but just finding, she doesn't, I mean, they're, one of them in particular is kind of loud. So she, I don't think she wants to like disturb everybody in the dorm.
I think that's good. Yeah. Yeah. Even though I'm sure it's very beautifully played there, you know, it is a very personal thing. And so I'm sure that that's the case. I'm quickly looking up practice rooms to see if I can find any information.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, there are practice rooms. Okay. Let me see if I can put this link in the chat. Oh, it's not a good link, but they do have practice rooms, so we're good. Okay. Oh, you know, another thing, Gloria, if you, is it okay if I call you Gloria?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So another thing, Gloria, is that we have, you know, which you might find interesting, I don't know, is every year we have we have two programs that feature talented students. So we have something called Cup of Culture. So a student who has a talent could sign up to perform at this Cup of Culture, and that's a residence life program. And then we also have a talent show called Revelle's Got Talent. So if you're interested in just like winning a talent show, that would be something that she could look forward to too.
Okay, great.
And she'll find all of these things out by following All Things Revelle on Instagram if that's something she's interested in. We also send a weekly newsletter to all of our students through email that has a list of all the activities that are happening in Revelle and then some things on campus every single week. They get it on Sunday night so they can plan their week. So we hope the students read it. Know to open it because the computer tells us, but I don't know if they read it. So encourage them to read it if they're interested.
Thank you. I know this generation has like a 10 second attention span and just swipe, swipe, swipe.
Absolutely. It's true. It is true. So it's interesting you say that because it's like a paradox. Our students are that way, but they love and crave connection with each other. And this is something that I've learned by working at Revelle in the last couple of years that is fascinating to me. What they'll do, this is like, I'm like describing, you know, like animal behaviors. This is what they do. They'll be like, I am an advisor for this creative group of students. They do graphic design and photography, and they are connecting all meeting, but they're all connecting by looking up something on their phone and talking about it with another person. And then that person says, oh yeah, I've seen that. And they're like, what about this? And so they're connecting very, very meaningfully, but through their devices. And I'm like, this is fascinating to me because I'm like, let's just talk. So they're like, no, Janet, no, have you seen that meme? Blah, blah, blah. I'm like, no, I don't know what that is. And they're like, okay, here, let me show it to you. So it's really interesting that even though they have an attention span that's like that, they still want to connect with each other, but they'll do it through that. And maybe you've already seen that. That's probably like a high school thing that I, now my kids are older and I'm not seeing that. But
yeah,
it's fascinating.
It's fascinating, and it's great because she found her roommate. She's already connected in that search with a lot of new people at San Diego. So I feel like she's going in knowing people. And so Sima, I don't know if your daughter has done that, but she could, you know, start reaching out to people even getting on campus. And I think that there's so many opportunities to meet outside of being in person now that are actually great. And I think they kind of saved her too during the pandemic.
Right. Yeah, Sima, I really want to make sure that we get your student connected to other students. Mm-hmm. We just need to know who she, what is your daughter's name? Sima.
Should I commit the cardinal sin of giving her name?
Oh, yeah. Out in public? Yeah, see, this is where we get into some tricky territory.
I'm learning from you.
Like, Mom, did you give my name to somebody at Revelle? Because she reached out.
I will email you. Thank you.
I mean, it's okay. Whatever you can offer that we're here for her, and then she can decide whether she wants to access us. But you're right, Sima C. Thank you for helping me. Thank you. That's good. You're good. You're going to pass. You are going to pass. Any other questions from anyone?
Hi, Janet. This is Jay. Thanks for all the information. It's really nice. I have very basic questions, three questions. One is like, are there any specific phone carriers which have good reception there across the campus?
Okay.
And a question tied to that is, do the students get free Wi-Fi on the campus? So at least there is some way to like connect with them anytime. That's question number one. Question number two is about, I heard some of the UCs have some like support program for them to get a new laptop or computer. I was wondering if you guys have similar kind of program. And the third thing was, our student has some food restriction, and she also got into Discovery Hall. So I was wondering if there is any place where she can cook a little bit here and there. So those were the main stuff curious about.
Awesome. Great. Okay, so to talk about the carriers and the Wi-Fi, I can't recommend a specific carrier necessarily. I personally have Verizon, and that seems to work well on campus because I'm on campus using my phone every 5 minutes. So the students seem to use, they've never talked about which ones they have, but I know in my experience, Verizon works fine. If that answers your question. Mm-hmm. And then as far as Wi-Fi, yes, there is free Wi-Fi all over campus. Occasionally there's a dead spot, and they're like, the Wi-Fi. But when they move on campus, there's, we have what's called ResNet. So they will be available to help the students get on the internet. And everything is definitely connected. Like, that's one great thing about UCSD, a very connected campus. So everything is available to them. Because there's a lot of online activity, and with classes, there's things that they do online. Even if they have an in-person class, they still do things online. So the Wi-Fi is available to them all the time. So you can connect with them, however you prefer, through that. You could text or WhatsApp or whatever you want to do. You can, all of that is available to you. Does that answer that question?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
I think Kurt has something to say.
Hey, I just wanted to say I've been to campus a couple of times in the last few months. I have, my son and I have T-Mobile, and it's not great. It has some issues. So I understand nobody wants to recommend it, but I would not necessarily recommend T-Mobile or any of its, breakoff companies like Mint or something. So just so you know.
Oh, that's good to know. I was about to get a T-Mobile for her. So.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't spent a lot of time around Revelle. It's mostly been in the center at the Price Center. but my son and I both had issues with connectivity, and you know, wasn't really that crowded, so it shouldn't have been that. But anyway, sorry to interrupt.
Thanks. No, that's great information. That's great, because the students don't talk to me about that stuff, but I'm just knowing that from my personal experience, Verizon always seems to work, and I'm like very dependent on my phone now for my job. So I'm all over campus doing stuff, and I have the phone. The phone is like in my hip pocket all the time. So Verizon might be an option for you. I don't know if anyone else has anything they'd like to share in that realm, but that's a great question, because there's nothing worse. This is what I always tell the students at orientation. I said, you know, we just want to know how you're doing. So if we text you like, hey, how's it going? And then we get nothing back from you, like even a K, or I'll get back to you in a second. You know, it's kind of like it is now when they're in high school. It's like, just give us something that shows us that you're fine. You know, you don't have to have a big old long conversation. But, you know, I said, we just automatically think the worst, or I do. I'll speak for myself. I said, I think the worst. So if you could just give me a K, or I'll get back to you in a second, or I'm good, or a smiley face, or a thumbs up, or whatever, just do something that I know you got it. That helps. So that's not related to
exactly.
The
service. Exactly.
But we do want to get in touch with them. We have to kind of let them, you know, do their thing. This is something I forgot to mention in my presentation. If you'll indulge me for one more minute, is the when I would call my kids, I would always be like, is this call for me or is this call for them? You know, because sometimes we're just wanting to reach out to them for us and not for them. And it's kind of a strange thing to think about, but you know, if we're just trying to like fill our void that's there by calling them all the time, you know, I don't know if that's going to work so well, because you know, they're busy. They may be in class. Like I said, they may be at the gym. They may be at the library. They may be in a study group, and they don't want to call. They don't want to talk on the phone right now, or they don't even want to take 5 minutes to get back to you on text. And we have to respect that. And so sometimes I'd always check myself. I'm like, why do I want to call my kid right now? I think I'm feeling lonely. Okay, guess what? I need to do something to take care of myself because they're doing their thing. And if they're worried about me, that's not giving them the full experience. So that's just.
Makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, you're welcome. And Jay, before I move off your questions, I put a library lending computer, a link to library lending. So they do lend laptops long-term, if that's something that you're interested in. And then there are laptops around campus. And the bookstore does have really great deals on laptops at the beginning of the school year. So if you wanted to look into the bookstore website on laptop deals, you could do that. And then the eating. So Discovery Hall is one of our original residence halls, one of the original UC San Diego residence halls, like from 1964. So they do not have a kitchen in Discovery Hall, which is unfortunate. And sometimes the students are kind of salty about that. They're like, I don't have a kitchen. But they usually make friends with someone who lives in Argo or Blake, which are right next door to Discovery. And Argo and Blake have kitchens. So my suggestion is if she needed to cook something, maybe she could just ask one of her friends who she meets who lives in Argo or Blake if she could use the kitchen with them. If there are a lot of restrictions and they need to have a plan with the dining services, that's available too. Is that something you might need?
Yeah, and I think, most of the part she should be okay. Because of this strict vegetarian diet, I think that's where you want to have something. And there is no way to kind of switch to Argo or one of the other ones, right?
No, not at the moment. No, there isn't. Okay. Yeah, but you know what? I'm a vegetarian also. And I know that UCSD, so this is, the students always get tired of the food because, you know, that's just what they just do. I'm like, there's so much great food. And they have a lot of great chefs on campus, which do not believe me, but it's true. I know how much work they put into creating menus for the students, but they have a very diverse offering of food on campus. So they don't have to eat just in Revelle. They can go to another college there's a lot of stuff in the Price Center. Like there's a lot of restaurants on campus that are very different from what they get in 64. So there is a Plant Power restaurant in Sixth College, so they can eat at Plant Power. There's a vegetarian restaurant in Muir College called Roots, and that's all vegetarian. There are vegetarian options in almost every dining facility. I do know in the Price Center, they have a lot of retail, you know, this is where they'd have to pay money or Triton cash. They, you know, there's all different kinds of things in there too. There's salad places, there's an Indian place. There's like, I don't eat there, but there's like a acai bowl type place, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So there's a lot of options for your student to eat vegetarian.
Right.
There's a lot of vegetarians. We have a lot of vegetarians in our college. So
yeah. It's one level above vegetarian a little bit. Yeah, it's not vegan, but yeah, it's a little bit complicated. But yeah,
yeah. I understand that. Yeah, and it's okay. She'll find her way there for sure. Okay, Thank you. Kathy, you had unmuted. Do you have a question?
Oh yeah, hi Janet. Thanks for everything. You know, I just have one question. My son, you know, we haven't received the result for the dorm yet, but we initially applied for the single bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was no option for him to go into, you know, how just in case, I noticed it says it's not guaranteed. So if he doesn't get it, you know, I thought there would be a choice of putting some preferences about the roommates, just in case he gets into two beds or three beds.
Mm-hmm.
But it just kind of skipped through everything and didn't give us any choice. So I'm just wondering, just in case he doesn't get it, what happens?
Okay, if he doesn't get the single room.
Yeah.
Okay.
Since it's not guaranteed.
It is not guaranteed. And yeah. I'm speaking as someone who does not work in residence life. This is just stuff I know from working.
Yes, yes.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So this is not, my answer is not official, but this is what I think I know. It's my understanding that single rooms, well, they're few and far between. And there's quite a few students on campus who require accommodations for one thing or another, you know?
Okay.
And so this is what I've heard, is that almost always the single rooms are there to support students who need accommodations.
Okay.
So it's not very easy for a student to just get a single room.
Okay. And
frankly, I kind of don't think that's a terrible thing, because I do think that it's good for our students to kind of just do the residence hall thing, you know, and live with a roommate, sleep in a bunk bed. You know, I've had parents say there's no way my student can sleep in a bunk bed. And it's like, they can't. It's okay. They can.
Yeah.
And, you know, they really feel good about themselves when they manage this environment they're in. So I kind of think like not being in a single is almost better for our students.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with that. And then, I mean, I'm okay with that option too, because we just chose that because he was saying that and he's like, we can apply for that and see what happens. But I was kind of, you know, I'm okay with him, you know, spending time with other people in the same room. It's a good experience, I believe. But my question was, since we couldn't really write down the preferences, you know, how you have, you know, there's important stuff. If you share a room, if a major stuff kind of matches it, it's good. But since we chose the single, we didn't have that choice. I wasn't sure how that works.
Right. Oh boy, I wish I knew more about the roommate selection process.
Uh-huh.
I have heard that there was an opportunity to fill out kind of like your profile.
Yeah, that part was kind of completely skipped. I don't know why, you know, when he was applying for, I was next to him and it just jumped to the final stage and it didn't give him the choice of putting so that's why I was always wondering.
Did anybody else on this call have that experience where you were not able to fill out a profile about your students, or the student wasn't able to fill it out, or did you fill it out?
I don't know the answer.
My son filled it out. So
he did fill it out. Okay.
And he was able to actually, was lucky that connected to somebody that was near us that lives here. They don't go to the same school, but they don't know what kind of room they're going to get. They just know that they're going to be together. So they don't know if they have a two or a three.
but they're gonna be roommates. So
just in case, in a worst scenario, let's say if he meets a roommate where he absolutely cannot stand, or then what's the procedure of, like, is there a chance to change the roommate, or he's stuck with that person?
I wouldn't say that they're stuck with that person, but it's you know, we have a lot of students and it's very hard to place students, so you know, they don't encourage like a lot of swapping around, you know, they really don't. It's just impossible administratively to do that.
Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah, I would encourage your student to kind of explore, and I know you know this, explore different people, you know, like different it's a really very exciting time for them to, you know, meet different types of people. And they meet so many different people, because not only is it a room, but then they're in a suite, you know, with other students. So like there's a room, like a common area, and then a room, you know? So
yeah,
if they're not like besties with their roommate, they're probably going to meet someone they really like who's in their suite.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then it's, you know, they're fine with their roommate, but they hang out with their suite mates. That's what I've heard, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. And that's how it worked with my kids. They were like, my roommate's fine, they're fine, I like them, but I hang out with the person who lives across the hall from me, you know, that's more.
Okay.
I think Alex, the student, also made a good comment about that, about, you know, making sure to have noise counseling headphones and the opportunity to learn how to discuss challenges with other people about how to address, you know, you know, can we, how can we make this so it's not noisy and I can sleep?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I'm sure everything will be a good, like, learning experience and growing up experience that he will, you know, face with the other kids who are different from him.
It's true.
Yeah. But I just wanted to ask, you know, how it's going to be done. So I'm right after we did that, I kind of regret. I mean, because if he just said hard time finding a roommate, he even went to the you know, Instagram, and you know where all the kids post the roommate search,
right?
And yeah, and then he was saying, you know, not that many Revelle kids posted, and then there were a lot of girls but not boys. So he was like, it's so hard to find in that way. And he doesn't know anybody there in that area. So he was just like, okay, single room will be fine. And then once I get the friend, we can just move to, you know, starting from next year, we can do a roommate.
Right.
That's why we decided to do that. Yeah.
I understand that thought process. I do.
Yeah.
I believe it is a girl thing to post more than.
Yeah, a lot of girls.
not to be stereotypical, but I. Since I do the analytics for our Instagram account, I see who checks, and it gives the people who check. So like 70% female are on Instagram.
Yeah.
So that makes sense to me, just like, you know, through the numbers.
Yeah, my son doesn't even have an Instagram. He only joined it to see, go in there and see.
Right. So this is what's good. So when they go through orientation, they're put in a group, and, you know, they're led by an orientation leader, and you met those folks in the panel. And so that's a small group of students, you know, like 10. And so they automatically meet 10 to 12 people, and they hang out with them all day at orientation. And so they're going to meet students there. They're going to meet the student in their, who's their roommate, and then all the people in the suite too. So there's ample opportunity for your son to meet other folks. And so I understand, like, having everything all worked out ahead of time. I think that that feels good for us. But I do think that it's okay if they don't know everything, if it's not all figured out. I do. But I understand the feeling right here. You're like, ugh. You want to figure it out.
Yeah. So when you shared about that bad experience story about, as a parent, you know, jumping into that Instagram posting thing that you had shared, I'm like, I know, I'm like, oh, okay, I should not do that. I totally understood where you were coming from.
Don't do it. Oh my God. And you know, the funny thing is that this other mom reached out to me, who lived in New York at the time. And she's like, oh, I'm sorry that you're feeling all these things. And she's like, it would be great if our kids can meet. And we're like, yeah, that'd be great. And they even were in the same major, but they never met. And we never orchestrated it. And I'm glad we did, because that probably would have really sent Cameron over the top. But they never met, but it was fine. You know, he met other people.
Yeah. Okay,
there's a few questions in the chat that I want to get to. I saw suggestions on how parents, that's you, Seema. Okay, how they can get involved as international parents, international students. Definitely a lot of information out there on how to get involved. And then, Mayra, I gave you a name of a person to contact by email about your question. She is...